Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome. My name is Andres Martinez. I'm Vice President and Editorial Director here at the New America Foundation. Thank you all for joining us today for the latest installment in our Future Tense series. Future Tense is a partnership between the New America Foundation, Slate Magazine, and Arizona State University. We do live events as we are today, and we also have a dedicated channel on slate.com. And Tori Bosch, who's sitting in the back of the room, stand up, Tori, take a bow. She is our fantastic editor at Slate. So we want to welcome you all today. First, I just want to make a housekeeping note, which is bear in mind that we are live streaming the event, so it'll be archived online. And obviously, it's all on the record for all of eternity. But the relevance of this is, if we have Q&As, please wait for the microphone and identify yourself. You can follow along and join the conversation on Twitter using the hashtag NeuroLaw. At the end of the day, we've built in some time for coffee and refreshments at 2:15, so we can all mingle and continue the conversation. So also, that's another opportunity to engage the speakers with questions if we don't get to it during the session. Today's topic is one that I think perfectly embodies what we try to do at Future Tense, which is to look at the policy and cultural implications of changes in technology and of emerging technologies. And this question of that we've somewhat playfully tried to frame as "my brain made me do it," seems to be at the intersection of science, with all of that we're learning about neuroscience in our brain, culture, in terms of what we understand the meaning of being human and what we understand by free will and what that means, and of course policy, particularly in the judicial context and in the sort of the age-old struggle to define, you know, what constitutes causality, personal responsibility, and so forth. So without any further ado, I want to kick us off by introducing our first speaker, who is going to give a short presentation to kind of set the framework for the rest of the day. Stephen Morse is the Associate Director of the Center for Neuroscience and Society at the University of Pennsylvania Law School. He's a professor of both law and psychiatry. He's the co-editor of a primer on criminal law and neuroscience and foundations of criminal law. Professor Morse?
How do I turn this on so I get? Okay. I want to thank the organizers for doing this, and here's what I'm here to tell you today, which is that of course your brain made you do it. Your brain is involved in the causation of all behavior. If your brain is dead, you're not doing much of anything at all. Having said that, what I'm also here to tell you is what we've learned about the brain so far is not going to make the world a kinder, gentler, and more verdant place. It's not going to transform criminal justice policy. And most of what we know in neuroscience today, although it's good science, is not yet legally relevant. Okay, I'm going to start off with a quick case study. Now, I can't possibly do this justice. This is a scan, structural scan, of a 40-year-old school teacher who had a lifelong interest in pornography, but not child pornography. About a month before the scan was taken, he started developing an intense interest in child pornography, downloaded it, went to massage parlors where he got more than massages. Totally unusual behavior for him. No one was noticing anything, though, not his wife, not his stepdaughter. And then one afternoon, he molested his stepdaughter. She ratted him to mom. He was convicted of child molestation. Because he had no record whatsoever, he was a good provider, a good homeowner, they were going to send him into an inpatient program that was going to help him with his sexual problem. He failed it, and he failed it because he was constantly molesting or importuning for sexual favors other patients and staff. If he failed it, and he knew this, and he didn't want to go to prison, this was an upper middle class guy, if he failed it, he had to go to prison. So the night before he was about to be sentenced, he develops an intense headache. He's admitted to the hospital. The next thing you know, he gets frankly neurological. He's got problems with his gait. In a neurological examination, he couldn't write properly and stuff like that. I'll show you. This is him before resection. This is him after resection. So here's what happens. At the end of this neurological examination, by the way, during which he's urinating on himself and not concerned, he's importuning the staff for favors. So he's really looking quite out of it and bizarre. And he's frankly neurological. What, you don't have to be a neuroscientist or a neurosurgeon to realize that shouldn't be there. That's a hemangiopericytoma. It's a very fast-growing, non-metastatic, but fast-growing tumor. And basically, it's going to kill him. So they resected it. They took it out. 2 days later, he can copy the designs. He can draw a clock. He's no longer neurological at all. And he reports, my interest in child pornography and kids is gone. They send him back to the program for inpatient treatment. He succeeds. Well, do we know the tumor has anything to do with it? It could have been coincidence. Well, here's what happens. 8 months later, he reports the interest in child pornography once again. Guess what else was back? The tumor was back. So this is everyone's favorite intuition pump. Every neurologist that has ever talked about this case says, this case is a one-off. You can't infer anything from it. I used to not want to talk about it at all because it's a one-off, and what can you infer from this one case? But now I embrace it, because if the kind of approach I'm going to give you works for this case, it works for any case. I don't do very interesting slides. It's just an outline, right? You've now seen my most interesting slides already. It goes downhill from here. Okay, I'm going to be talking about what neuroscience can bring to the law and bring to our picture of ourselves generally. I take the law as it is. By that I don't mean I think the law is perfect. What I'm going to try to do is give an account that takes law generally as it is and doesn't try to have fantasies about what the law might be. I'm not a dualist. I don't believe we have minds that are independent of our bodies and that somehow we're in causal connection with them or anything like that. I'm a pure physicalist. I'm a naturalist. It's all bottom up, not top down. When I say multi-F, multi-L, what I mean by that is when you're going to explain something like complex human behavior, an adequate explanation is going to have to take into account many fields, biology, psychology, sociology, and it's going to have to look at different levels within each of those fields. So if you want a full biological explanation, you could work at the cellular level, you could work at the systems level. I mean, it's going to... And again, what particular thing you are trying to explain, more of the variance may be accounted for by one field or one level than another, but in complex human behavior, which is the most complicated thing there is that we know about, it's going to be multi-field, multi-level. And, okay, the law is implicit psychology and concept of the person. Excuse me for being breathtakingly superficial. Law is a system of rules and standards that's meant to guide behavior. It does other things as well, but that's its primary function. Notice, by the way, it's just like morality, etiquette, social norms, all of which are meant in part, in large part, to help us guide human behavior. Now, what kind of creature could be guided by rules and standards? Not machines, not to the best of our knowledge, other animals. Oh, you want me to work from here? Well, I can't hold two things at once, so I'll work from here. Yeah. I like to move around a lot, but I got to have this and I got to have that. All right. So, what kind of creature? Human beings. We are reason-responsive creatures. That's what we are. And by the way, this does not, again, mean anything that's inconsistent with a naturalistic picture. I mean, we don't know how this happened, but natural selection and evolutionary processes have evolved us to be the kinds of creatures that act for reasons. If I were to ask any of you, why are you sitting in this room today? I don't know what the story is, but even Kent Keel wouldn't tell me a story about his brain and his nervous system. He'd tell me a story about he'd like to, and maybe someday he'd be able to. But what are we basically going to do? I desire to learn something about neuro and the future. I believe that by coming to this program, I would learn something about it. Therefore, I formed the intention to be here, and here I am. It's a reason-giving explanation. That's what we use to explain to ourselves what we're up to and to others what we're up to. It's called folk psychology. And that, by the way, is not a pejorative. That is a technical term in philosophy of mind and action and in psychology to refer to an explanation of human behavior that uses mental states as partial, and I want to stress partial, explanations of behavior. Because again, If we're going to explain why you're in this room today, we'd also, if we were going to give a full explanation, we'd deduce biological variables, sociological variables, as well as other psychological variables. But certainly, the folk psychological desire, belief, intention explanation is a major part of why you're here. And that is the law of psychology. If you think about legal criteria, especially for responsibility, they're all about actions and mental states. That's all there is. Now, if you ask, how come we hold some people responsible and not others? What are the law's criteria for responsibility? What I want to suggest to you is the primary general responsibility criterion is you have rational capacity. Now, how much rational capacity you have is a normative question. There's no right answer in the sky. We could be tough about it. We could be tender about it. But think about the classes of people generally who are inclined to excuse or mitigate if they misbehave. Young children, people with severe mental disorders, people with dementias, what do they all have in common? What they all have in common, either as a result of developmental immaturity or as a result of some kind of disability, is that their rational capacity is impaired. And that is the fundamental criterion for responsibility in law, and I would like to suggest in morals as well. And here I think law and morality track each other very well indeed. Now, forget about free will. None of you has it. I don't have it. Nobody has it. No one ever did have it. No one ever will have it. If having free will in the sense of being able to act uncaused by anything but yourself, and think how preposterous that is in the modern scientific age. I mean, there are still some people out there who believe we have that. They tend to be professors because they get very inflated views of, you know, what they are able to do. But even though we don't have that strong sense of free will, the ability to act uncaused by anything but ourselves, we do have reasons responsiveness. We are agents. We are the kind of creatures that can deliberate and act for reasons. Now, I'm not saying we always do. Lots of what we do is automatic, thoughtless, and the like. But we have the ability, when it's important to us, to step back and to act for reasons, to deliberate. Now, which leg you put through your undershorts in the morning, you never think about. You've been doing probably the same way since you first learned to dress yourself. Why should you think about it? But if you're about to harm another person or infringe their interests, then you have reason to think about it. And that's what we expect people to do, to deliberate and take into account the good reasons that they have. So that's from the point of view of what's called in the philosophy of responsibility, the compatibilist position. That kind of capacity to act for reasons when something is at stake, to be reasons responsive, is all you need to be a responsible agent. You don't need to have this godlike power of being able to act uncaused by anything but yourself. And as a matter of the law, free will or its lack is not a legal criterion in any law anywhere. In criminal law, for example, the prosecution never has to prove the defendant had free will, and the defendant, to get excused, never has to show that he didn't have free will. So people say, well, gee, okay, it's not a criterion in law, an actual criterion, but it's foundational. If we don't have free will, as the little blurb for this meeting says, if we don't have free will, you know, how can we ever be responsible? But here's what's true. Think about the criteria for being, let's say, a murderer, someone who kills somebody intentionally. Some people act intentionally when they kill. Other people are accidental. Some people recognize that they're killing a human being. Other people may make a mistake. They thought it was a target dummy. Some people who kill are legally insane, and some people are not. Some people who kill do so because someone's holding a gun at their head and say, I'll kill you or else. Now, what's doing the excusing work in those cases is not free will or its lack. It's good folk psychological kinds of criteria. Gee, if you don't act intentionally, we're not going to attribute whatever it is that happens to you. If you don't recognize what you're doing, you're not responsible. If someone's forcing you, not in the sense of literally forcing you, but metaphorically forcing you, I'll kill you if you don't do X, it's going to be just a good folk psychological excusing condition. I was compelled in the metaphorical sense. All right. Those distinctions between two different kinds of actors, those who have the criteria and those who don't, are true facts about the world. No one could deny them. And notice, They track moral theories we have good reason to endorse, theories having to do with who deserves blame and praise, punishment and reward, who's going to be a dangerous agent and who isn't. So even if determinism is true and we don't have free will, there are people who act in ways that we think deserve our condemnation and those that don't. Come on. When you finally get to see a neuroimage of something, you have to ask precisely, how precisely do neuroscientific findings answer a legal question? Notice that neuroscience is entirely mechanistic. Neurons, the connectome, neural systems do not have aspirations. They don't have goals. They don't have a sense of past, present, and future. They're biomechanical systems. Only agents, people like us, actually have goals, aspirations, a sense of past, present, and future. Law is folk psychological. Neuroscience is mechanistic. How do you do the translation? You can't just wave your hand and say, look, he's got a hole in his head, therefore he's not responsible. You have to translate that hole in the head into the actual excusing condition. What I would like to suggest to you today is most of what we know from neuroscience is rhetorically relevant, not yet really relevant. Now, by and large, the new neuroscience is an infant science. And it's not surprising that we don't know as much as some people wish we knew, because we're working on some of the hardest problems there are with basically a brand new technology. So I'm not surprised that we don't know as much as we would like to. And we're going to learn more as time goes on. But for now, most of what we know is not relevant. I have a whole actions speak louder than images. Ultimately, because law is about acts and mental states, you have to believe the actions. If somebody is acting psychotically, I have no reason to believe they're malingering. I don't care how normal their brain looks. They're a psychotic agent and probably should be excused. If someone has a really broken-looking brain, but they're acting totally rational, it's a rational agent, at least for legal purposes. All right, now I've got a whole bunch of things about why we don't know as much as we do, but I can skip that. This is the major claim. This is what scares people. Are we really agents, the kind of creatures who can act for reasons, who can respond to reason, or are we just victims of neuronal circumstances? In other words, we are helpless puppets buffeted about by our brains, our genetics, and our alleged mental states is just simply something the brain makes up sort of to snooker us after the brain has already done what we're going to do. If that were true, if we were just victims of neuronal circumstances, then all bets are off. Because then the whole basis of responsibility is gone. Because the basis of responsibility is a reason-responsive creature. Now notice, there are two versions of us that could be true, and both are consistent with determinism. One, we have evolved to be deterministically reason-responsive creatures. Two, we have evolved to be just victims of neuronal circumstances, and our beliefs about our agency, about our reason-responsiveness, are simply an illusion. Both of those are consistent with the truth of determinism. I will just wave my hand at this. There is nothing, nothing in the current neuroscience, nothing that would lead you to conclude that you're just a victim of neuronal circumstance. The radical reductionist program may ultimately turn out to be true. I really doubt it. But there is nothing, for all sorts of reasons I could give you if I had about 2 hours, but there is nothing in the science that should cause you to give it up yet. Now, Mr. Oft, and I'll finish with him. The way to think about him is not did his tumor make him do it. Yes, he would not have had pedophilic desires if it hadn't been for his tumor. We know that because of the way the time series worked. But all pedophiles are caused to be pedophiles by something, right? So why is he any less responsible than any other pedophile? And I want to distinguish for you between two periods, and I'll quit. Period number one, when he touched his stepdaughter, that was one crime. Then no one noticed anything. His wife didn't notice anything. He was doing fine at work. Seemingly, his rational capacities at that point were relatively intact. By the time he was, let's say, committing assault on the nurses in the neurological consulting room some months later, then he looked much, much less rational. So, I don't know enough about the time he touched his stepdaughter, but what I know is I have to evaluate his rational capacity then. That's what's doing the work, not the tumor. The conclusion of all this? We are acting agents, not Pinocchios, and our brains are not Geppettos pulling the strings. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Morse. That was terrific. And next time my 8-year-old is sitting on the couch wanting to just stare at a screen, I'm going to say, don't just sit there like a victim of neuronal circumstance. It's a great term that I learned here. To continue drilling down a little bit on the science and assess where we are with this emerging understanding of the brain, I'm going to ask Laura Helmuth to moderate a conversation, Does a Brain Scan Tell All? Laura is the science and health editor at our partner, Slate Magazine, and she has a PhD in cognitive neuroscience from the University of California, Berkeley. She previously was a senior editor at Smithsonian Magazine and an editor at Science Magazine. And Laura will introduce the panelists and the conversation. Thank you. Yes.
Thank you very much. So I'll just do a quick introduction and then we'll get right into the discussion. And at the end, we'll open it up for questions from the audience. And also, you know, I think we'll be asking each other questions. You should all feel free to get in each other too. So Kent Keel is an associate professor of psychology at the University of New Mexico. He studies psychopathy, neuroimaging, and how to use this research to inform state and federal judges about issues regarding neuroscience and the law. He was, I'm sure we've got a lot of New Yorker readers here. There was a nice story about him in 2008 in the New Yorker and his work studying psychopathic brains in prisons. And then Kayla Pope is the director of neurobehavioral research at Boys Town National Research Hospital in Nebraska. She's a child and adolescent psychiatrist and she's an attorney. And then Sally Sattel is a resident scholar here in town at the American Enterprise Institute. She's a psychiatrist at the Partners in Drug Abuse and Rehabilitation Counseling. And the author of several books, including PCMD, How Political Correctness is Corrupting Medicine, and another one that might be relevant today, Drug Treatment, the Case for Coercion. So I'll start out, the day is sort of divided into philosophy, science, and then legal implications of the science and the philosophy. So we're going to sort of switch now and in our panel talk about the science. What is the neuroscience that's happening now? You know, some of it's very fresh and new. And what are we learning from it? What are the implications? So to be clear, and I think each of the panelists will talk a little bit about their own research and what methods they use, but there isn't just one kind of brain scan. Each one has its, you know, pros and cons. There's just straight MRI, which gives you a really precise 3D image of the brain, which bits are big, which bits are small, are they misshapen, or are they in the wrong place? You get functional MRI, which shows which parts of the brain are, you know, are kind of standard metaphors lighting up, which parts are active. And then diffusion tensor MRI kind of shows how the different bits are interconnected and how strongly connected they are. And so each of these kind of tells you different things about the brain. And I think we'll get in, as we go through this, we'll get into a little bit more about what the limitations are, what we know so far. But let me start by just asking each of the panelists to tell us a little bit about your own work. So Kent, could you start by telling us a little bit about the sort of subjects you study and what pattern, what are the, like, the biggest patterns that you find?
Sure, so my lab is generally oriented towards trying to understand the issues that individuals who end up in a forensic context, how they've come to get there, how they've come to, what are the biological, environmental, and, you know, genetic reasons why individuals end up getting themselves in a lot of trouble, generally speaking. My lab mostly focuses on individuals who you would term having psychopathy or psychopathic individuals. We also do a lot of work with patients with schizophrenia and other mental illnesses, and we study them from about age, in my lab, about age 10 to about age 60. And the the goal of the work is to try to develop a better way to develop treatments for those individuals to help reduce the cost and incidence of recidivism and other poor, you know, outcomes, stuff like that. The latest science, basically from our lab, has shown, which has generally been very concerning to the legal system, has been that, you know, we are able to use brain images to say that a patient's brain does have, you know, fits a pattern of other patients' brains and will meet a distribution. So patient comes into the emergency room, you have a diagnosis of being talking to yourself or whatever, and you might be diagnosed with schizophrenia or bipolar or some other illness, and it turns out that the pattern of brain activity from that person can be fit to a distribution and say, well, that person actually has schizophrenia. And so in cases like the Loeffner case in Arizona or the one up in Aurora in Colorado, you know, people are very concerned about, well, what does that person actually have? Do they have a mental illness? Do they have those types of problems? And then the question is, well, does that speak at all to whether or not there's a legal question behind there with respect to responsibility or something? And neuroscience is getting very, very, very accurate at being able to predict and to look at those things. We now have data from other groups that shows we can predict who's going to develop those types of illnesses early, so they're called at-risk or prodromal. But in my lab, what we focus on is the individuals who you would say would be on like the life course persistent trajectory of antisocial behavior, the individuals who have very, very, very severe antisocial trajectories. They do very, very, very bad things. And how did they get that way and how did they develop that way? Mm-hmm. And as Stephen mentioned, to echo his sentiments, is that given that their behavior is so different and the personality that they have is so different, their brains are different. And we are now able to say how they're different and how they, potentially how they got that way, or was it there from birth, or was it there from early age? And that challenges the way people think about free will, it challenges the way people think about responsibility, but most of my lab is, again, designed towards trying to translate that information into a way to more effectively treat and manage them. Mm-hmm. That's generally where we're at.
And I think on the panel, you work with the most severe cases, right? A lot of your people are in prison,
Not just any prisoners. Most of the facilities we've worked at have been maximum security. We do make use of a very unique system. So the nonprofit that I work at, the Mind Research Network, has a mobile MRI system. And we take that system and have deployed it in 8 prisons in 2 states to scan and bring that science to this high-risk population for the first time. And so that was what the New Yorker article was about, was we've scanned over 2,500 individuals who volunteered for research and treatment studies in those populations, from men to women to children or youth, and including forensic psychiatric and even the super highest risk, you know, civilly committed sex offenders. We've studied them as well. And again, the goal is to try to help understand how they got there and then how to develop a better way to keep them from doing it again, or prevent it, ideally.
Great. Yeah, so we'll come back to some more about what the implications are of that and what exactly we can know and say about individuals. But I wanted to move on to Kayla, and if you could tell us about, just remind people what Boys Town is and what kind of kids you work with there.
So Boys Town is a large residential or campus-wide treatment program. We deal with about 900 kids on campus and about 20,000 kids in the local Omaha community, as well as treatment sites across the country. And our kids are not as acute as the ones that Kent's been working with. But these are kids that come from very troubled backgrounds, engage in all sorts of very troubling behavior, and sort of a broad array of pathology, everything from anxiety, depression, to conduct disorder. But we do have a fair number of kids that if they weren't, they would probably be in a juvenile detention facility. So our focus at Boys Town, it's always been a behavioral modification program. But what we've come to realize over time is that that's not really sufficient for all kids, especially for some of these kids that have had very disturbed backgrounds or are engaging in very dangerous behaviors. So what Boys Town is now moving in the direction of is using imaging technology to better understand the pathology in some of these children, and also to really look at the biomarkers that we have now identified to see what interventions will actually be most effective in terms of altering brain circuitry. I think there's a lot of really good work that can be done in this area. And the comment that was made in terms of being victims of our neurocircuitry, maybe not so much a victim, but certainly a product in understanding what are the factors that influence that. I think a big gap in what we are looking at now is the developmental piece. We know very little about how these things unfold over time, and also the factors that really do influence. So the kids that come to our campus, the vast majority of them have had significant trauma. And there's no way that that has not impacted the way they approach the world, see threats, see fear in their environment, and certainly has an impact on their behavior. So that's what our program is designed to look at.
Nice. And Sally, what sort of patients have you specialized in? And as you know, in the past few years, as neuroscience and neuroimaging has gotten more and more sophisticated, has that kind of changed the approaches in the field, do you think?
Well, I approached this, my original interest began actually in 1995 in the context of working with people who are addicted. Mm-hmm. Excuse me. And what caught my eye especially was a new rhetoric that was being invoked to talk about the concept and the actuality of addiction itself, which is that it was a so-called brain disease. And that concept was reified by what at the time was one of the first functional neuroimaging devices, which was PET scan. So this was the about 1985. And we can get back to this a little bit later, but but I found that as a clinician that this was not a particularly an enlightening way to think about addiction, and in fact one that could often undermine the clinical goals in our clinical work. And that's been on the back burner of my mind for a very long time. And as brain scanning has become more and more of a cultural trope almost, and taken to this wider, gaining this wider territory in terms of what it says more writ large about, again, free will and moral responsibility and agency. So my interest expanded, along with that. But within psychiatry, it's clear that even though we're making lots of advances, and the DSM-6, when that comes out in, 2020 or whenever, because next year the DSM-5 is supposed to come out, it still hasn't, some of the predictions are almost poignant when you look back on what people thought they'd be able to do in the early 90s when the previous DSM-4 was under construction, was we'll be able to, have a biological, essentially biological indicators of these conditions that we call schizophrenia and bipolar. And when it comes out in next year or later next year, it won't be having that. So mm-hmm. In other words, we're still not nearly as advanced as psychiatrists thought they would be at this time.
Mm-hmm. So I think that's certainly true of neuroscience. We had a lot of grand ambitions early on, kind of like with the Human Genome Project. Everything's always 10 years away. But kind of disregarding for a minute, how many years it will take to get there, is the end point some sort of brain scanning technology that will identify, dangerous, not dangerous, schizophrenic, not schizophrenic? I mean, does it have the potential, do you think, to be as accurate as, say, DNA testing, or is it more like, hair follicle testing, which, sounded all science-y and accurate and forensically important a few decades ago and now is basically not useful at all? What sort of, looking long term, do you think neuroscience and especially neuroimaging can give us really important answers that will have legal implications?
I don't think the value of neuroimaging is going to be diagnostic mm-hmm. in the long run. I think it's really going to the value will be in helping us understand the pathology and how it develops over time, which will then lead treatment, more effective treatments. Mm-hmm. I know some people are now actually using the technology diagnostically, which has raised some controversy in the field because of its inaccuracy. But that's my opinion.
I would say that, I'm a psychologist and a neuroscientist, and as a psychologist, I want to try to quantify different, aspects of some function. So mm-hmm. if that's IQ or if that is whether or not a patient has a diagnosis, it meets criteria for some symptom cluster we call schizophrenia. The more accurately we define that psychological construct or symptom construct, the more likely there will be definitive neuroscience data that's going to fit that. So if you want to say, differentiate schizophrenia from healthy based on patterns of brain scans, well, that has to be based on some symptom pattern originally, but then fitting a new person's brain to that is fine. So, and in an example I think echoes both of our sentiments, one of the biggest questions right now in early diagnosis of mental illness like schizophrenia is, does a child who starts to withdraw and starts to, quit shaving and stop washing themselves and then locks themselves in their room, is that child on a slope towards that mental illness? And it turns out that if all of us in this room interviewed those children, et cetera, we could say that they meet symptoms for what's called a prodromal phase. But only 20% roughly around the world of kids who meet that criterion will convert to actually having the illness in kind of a 2 to 3 year period, the latest stuff. But the latest evidence suggests that when you combine that symptom assessment with neuroscience, you predict over the 80% threshold. And so if that's the case, then that's what they've used to decide when to treat. Mm-hmm. So that would be neuroscience helping to inform what's precipitating, or that they are on the steepest slope, and that they are going to develop that. With respect to dangerousness or predicting dangerousness, we have a paper in our lab that we've been looking at, or a study in our lab that we've been looking at. Well, if we quantify impulsivity, impulsivity predicts recidivism. So I could give you a pen and paper test, and you're going to fill it out, and it's going to say, well, you're not likely to recidivate. But I might be more impulsive, and then I'm more likely to recidivate. That's a risk factor. And then we might give you an abilities-based test. We might have you fill out a game, and it measures how many errors you make. And that predicts on top of that. But if I quantified impulsivity in your brain or measured it in terms of neural activity, are we any better? And the results suggest that we are. So there's incremental utility as a psychologist as I'm trying to capture brain function with a test, a game, or with a self-report, that the more accurately I assess that, via whatever technique I want to use, the more likely I am to predict if it's a useful variable in predicting an outcome. And so what that gives me is a goal that I now know about the neural system. I now know about that it's a risk factor. I now might have a medicine, or one of these two could provide a medicine that would treat them for that, for example. Or I might develop techniques that help to reduce impulsivity, which will then change brain function over time. And so that's what I think we can do. Mm-hmm. But the legal system has definitely been very interested in whether or not it's relevant now or not. And I think that from a theoretical perspective, there are some big questions. But on the ground, I think you're seeing a lot of people are being asked this. I mean, defense attorneys ask me all the time, should I be evaluating my client for this? And in a lot of cases, if they've had a history of head injury or a tumor, it's particularly relevant that you should get a brain scan. In fact, you might be, it might be overturned on ineffective assistance of counsel grounds if you don't have something to look at that. Just like you would ask for a psychologist or a neuropsychologist. Now the question just is, how far down can you go and say something specific about some mental illness or some condition? And then it's up to the judicial system to decide how to use that information or whether or not it's relevant.
Did you want to comment to this?
Yeah, I was going to mention that prediction for many things, for how one's going to respond to treatment, for future dangerousness. I mean, that is radically important. There's no question about that. But it's an and, not really but and. It's different, though. It overlaps with, but it's different from understanding. Mm. And in psychiatry in particular, one could argue we don't even know what schizophrenia is in that sense that, and in fact, the DSM acknowledges this by calling these things disorders or syndromes or collections of symptoms that have some, certainly they have some meaning in terms of the way that which they cluster in a general prognostic picture. But, ideally you, as a taxonomist of diseases, ideally you want the kind of condition that the diagnosis tells you, it looks backwards and forwards, it tells you the etiology, like you have a certain kind of pneumonia, that's Klebsiella pneumonia, so that's caused by that bacteria, and that largely indicates what kind of antibiotic you want to use. That model, just doesn't apply in psychiatry because there are often so many etiologies. Just for example, someone who is what we call schizophrenic at age 40, but who had a perfectly normal course until they were 19 and then didn't leave their dorm room and then didn't wash and then started becoming paranoid about their roommate, it's just got to be a different kind of schizophrenia than one that started with a child who was 5 and was never quite neurologically coordinated and always had imaginary friends and on and on and on. But my point is that there's just so much complexity in psychiatric conditions and the interaction with environment once you even have a gene that enhances your probability that I think we're a long way from really pinpointing exactly what causes many of these conditions.
I just want to go back to Ken's comments. So in terms, I think imaging at this point, and perhaps you'll disagree, is probably most effective in looking at population-based phenomenon. I mean, it's been very effective in helping us understand normal development with the work of Jay Geed and others, which has really guided some recent Supreme Court decisions on juvenile culpability. But I am very skeptical at this point that individual scans can really give us that much information.
You're not the first person to say that, and there's a large literature from my lab and others, mostly my work with Vince Calhoun, who says that you can actually, if you have a well-defined group, and Sally is correct too, that you need to have a well-defined group of individuals who had an onset within the standard range, and you're not looking at the ones that child or late onset, you're looking at this as homogeneous as a group as possible. It is actually not hard to take a pattern of brain imaging data and fit it to one of those distributions at the single subject level. We've published data showing that we're 98% accurate. And so for schizophrenia versus healthy, but again, that's not hard for us to do by just talking to them. But the patterns of brain activity are, I think, that accurate as long as you're inputting into the algorithm the best data that you can. And a lot of people make a lot of assumptions about the data that they put into those classification algorithms. Our data with schizophrenia versus bipolar disorder are very related, but even more psychiatrically, troubled, difficult to separate those two groups. Does a patient have schizophrenia or does a patient have psychotic bipolar disorder? That's a big problem and a big question for frontline psychiatrists, and our work has been guided to try to determine, can you take a brain scan and help improve the guesswork that they do right now? People along the judicial system or in the medical community have to make decisions, have to make decisions what to treat them with, have to make decisions what to diagnose them with. And I think that imaging can help sometimes make that diagnosis. That's what the goal is. I have more of an optimistic kind of view that you can use imaging to help make these predictions. And there's a lot of evidence from different groups that you're getting more and more and more reliable. But I don't think it should surprise people, like Stephen said, that for well-diagnosed mental illnesses, for well-diagnosed syndromes, even IQ or old versus young or any kind of process that we're trying to assess, there will be a very, very, very strong correspondence with neuroscience data at some point. It's coming. And it might not come in 10 years, it might be 20 years, but it's going to be there. And so the question is, why does that surprise people? There's a beautiful image of your brain when you look when you're 40, and yes, unfortunately, as I'm over 40, it starts to decline over time. And I can show you that it's going to decline over time. In particular, look at Steve. No, I'm just kidding. But we've been friends for a long time. And so the point is that you can see these changes, you can do this. I mean, we're on the heels right now of the FDA has recently just approved the first brain scan for Alzheimer's, right? A PET scan is now potentially diagnostic, FDA approved, for determining if you have Alzheimer's or not. And what it really says, the scan says, do you have plaques or not? Do you have the plaques that put you at risk? And they can say, hopefully, with some degree of specificity, yes or no. That you either don't have plaques, which then means you're likely not on that trajectory, or you do have plaques, in which case you have a much higher risk. That's what scans, I think, are going to be capable of doing with greater and greater efficiency as we move forward.
Kayla, could you tell us a little bit more about the work you did at NIH with in some of the work you've done on children, and specifically imaging? What sort of patterns are distinctive in kids with conduct disorder?
So before going to Boys Town, I was a research fellow at the National Institute of Mental Health, working in the lab of James Blair, whose life has been devoted to understanding the diagnosis of conduct disorder in children. And kind of building on what Kent was saying, we really need to understand this pathology with more discrete understanding of the subtypes of conduct disorder. So our lab has focused a lot on these callous and emotional traits in children and whether that maps onto a particular circuitry or particular dysfunction in various brain regions. And some of the emerging evidence has shown that for these kids with callous and unemotional traits, they really do have dysfunction in several parts of the brain, the amygdala being the most prominent, with you see hyporeactivity in these children in response to fearful stimuli, also some dysfunction in the frontal lobes, and also anterior cingulate, which is involved in the attentional system. So again, hoping that this information will help us better identify these children early on and to think about what interventions might be most effective. And again, at Boys Town, we work with a lot of these kids, and not all of them would meet criteria for callous and emotional, certainly, but they do respond to the model at Boys Town differently. The kids with more callous and emotional traits are oftentimes less responsive to the behavioral modification program that we have in place. So thinking about what is it that we could supplement this program with that would really be able to really address these callous and emotional traits.
And I wanted to get at that seems to be a very hot topic of research right now, the callous and emotional kids. And Is that a predictor of psychopathy in adults? And does that seem to be sort of the model right now, that they're at a greater risk of becoming, or of, you know, exhibiting some of the spectrum of psychopathic behaviors in the future?
I think hard to say. I mean, certainly it is a risk factor, but then again, I think we need to think about what are the environmental influences also at play. And a child who grows up in a healthy, normal environment who has these traits may end up following a very different career path. And I don't want to identify any particular groups in society, but...
It's a huge question for judges, right? It's a huge question. They always ask, I have a youth in front of me, I have lots of discretion about sentencing. Is this someone I should, you know, that's high risk or not? And we would all hope that they would say that there's capacity for change in anyone, and we would hope that even the kids on the steepest trajectory towards those traits and development of that lifelong problem potentially would be subjective to, you know, better forms of treatment. And I would echo that there's a program in Wisconsin that's at the Mendota Juvenile Treatment Center, which has shown that in that state, when they are sent the highest risk kids, these are the top 1% of all high risk offenders in the state of Wisconsin, that they can make significant impact. They can do amazing things. And this is an intensive year-long inpatient, you know, institutionalized treatment program. But they've shown over a 50% reduction in violent crime in the kids that complete their program versus the kids that don't. And all of their kids score very, very, very high on the Callison and emotional trait scales that we use in clinically and in research. And moreover, most of them come from horrendous environments. And so what's amazing is that this program has made such change. And 50% reduction in violent crime, that's millions of dollars. I mean, plus all the emotional victim costs, right? So it's an unbelievably effective program. And unfortunately, it was one of those things that's a casualty of many of the economic downturns, is that they want to limit the amount of, you know, funding there. And I just couldn't say enough good things about that program and the guys that work there and the development of it, because it's such an amazing... It really has changed the way I think about treating these kids. I mean, I've worked with adults that are psychopathic, serial killers, some of the worst. They've done some of the worst things imaginable. And a lot of these kids are on a trajectory like the man I've met with when they were adults. And here they are able to make a first, and it's the first, in my understanding, it's the first real attempt to work with these super high-risk kids on an individualized basis, taking into account all of what we know in the science of them to develop a better treatment program. And the first iteration works. The other thing that I think is shocking is there has never been a treatment study, a randomized placebo-controlled treatment study of psychopathy, ever. So how do we say we can't treat it if we've never tried? Right? So there's absolutely nothing that has been done in the area to try to implement state-of-the-art treatment. So we're just now doing some state-of-the-art imaging, and people are pretty interested in it. Imagine if we could do state-of-the-art treatment that would actually prevent poor outcomes in the future. No more Sanduskys, maybe. No more of those types of things. That's the goal.
Well, there have been randomized controlled trials of treatments for kids with a diagnosis of chronic disorder, but the results have been varied, and I think in large part because we haven't differentiated between these kids that are reactive versus...
Sure, well, there's 36,000 different combinations of items you can have to develop and get an assessment of chronic disorder. Alan Kasdan, the former APA president, argues that it's a very poor diagnosis, which is why I think DSM-5 is moving towards trying to get more and more accurate assessment. And this is what I was saying, is that if you poorly assess the behavior or the condition of interest, you're going to have crappy data, the neuroscience data. You have to be measuring the behaviors and the traits, whether it's IQ all the way up to Callison and emotional traits, as accurately as possible, or you're not going to have a neuroscience phenotype that matches. And that's what we typically see is, I'm not a fan of the diagnosis of conduct disorder. I don't think it's predictive. 80% of kids that have it don't ever develop anything as an adult. And so I don't think it's that helpful. I think you have to be measuring and looking at much more severe, higher risk kids if you want to have a neuroscience phenotype. Because most of those kids are just reactive to their environment, and they will likely grow out of it. And most of them don't deserve incarceration. Most of them deserve a good treatment program and go out of it. But I want to know about the kids that are on the steepest trajectory, that we can try to take them off that trajectory. That's the goal.
Can I just ask one of them a question? Probably sure. Want to move on to other things, but it wouldn't surprise me if there are kids like at five, and that's the age at which, or even four, when kids start exhibiting these sorts of things. I don't know how young, but does that sound
it's
reasonable?
It's hard, but okay, I mean, there's a lot of kids that act like that don't continue, but then there's the, yes, people there. Try to say that they can. Yeah.
Okay. There are some diagnostic instruments looking at kids as early as 2 and 3.
Okay. Well, that was actually my question, because in a way, I wonder if there is, if there is a kind of what you might even call an acquired psychopathy as opposed to a more innate one. And again, being raised in some, you know, hellhole with parents who are inattentive and cruel, and you know, learn that in and of itself. But those are the, well, I don't know if those were the children who would manifest it younger. I would think. I don't know. And if one group might be more responsive to treatment than others. I just don't know if this has been looked at. But
go ahead. I think there have been some twin studies, right? Showing that there definitely identical versus fraternal twins, showing that the identical ones share more callous and emotional traits, you know, suggesting that there definitely is some genetic component to it.
Oh, absolutely. And I think, I mean, some studies have looked at and predicted 40% is actually genetically attributed. But I think it's really a normal distribution. I think you're going to see some kids are highly genetically loaded, others are environmentally loaded, and it's going to be some magic combination of those two factors that's going to result in the pathology. I think with respect to your answer, we don't really know. There are some pretty good diagnostic instruments now, age 2 and 3, but the data isn't there in terms of what are the trajectories for these kids and the outcomes. But at least we're now starting to monitor and follow it.
There hasn't been enough longitudinal studies to look at those new instruments at age 2 and whether or not they predict outcomes and whether or not they're sensitive enough. But the thing that's interesting, though, is that they do tend to identify a range of individuals, and then individuals at this tail are believed to be needing of some assistance, some sort of treatment, something to get them hopefully back to the norm, right? That's what we're all, you know, trying to achieve. So that's what I would say, yeah.
Now, what are the implications if there are sort of two populations, ones who are, you know, extremely genetically loaded and the ones who are extremely environmentally loaded? And of course, I imagine most of them have both. You need both to really really aspire to horrible things. But you know, if there are these two populations, do you have a sense, and this might just be, you know, what you imagine, which group would be more amenable to treatment?
Intuitively, one would think that those that come from a more of an environmental would be more likely to be, you know, malleable and treatable, and the genetic would be harder. That's just, I think, a general statement. But what if the genetic happens to be, let's just say it's a certain neurotransmitter is deficient, and then we already have a drug that fixes that neurotransmitter or normalizes it. Well, then maybe that's easier to treat than the other one. I just don't think we have great data yet and large enough studies to indicate that, you know, these things. I'm more of a fan of taking the individual and trying to do the best assessments on that individual. That includes from their parents to their, you know, where they come from and the environments that they came from, to try to develop a plan that works best with that child. So,
it's funny. That's kind of an interesting dichotomy. It is kind of intuitive to think that if something was sort of environmentally or psychologically caused, it would be more tractable. Mm-hmm. That if you've ever done psychoanalysis, you know that's not true. And in fact, I've always thought, you know, when I see my patients, I'm a great believer in the notion that people use drugs for a reason. And I don't mean they start using drugs for a reason, which they do. They keep using drugs for a reason, so that's true of addicts as well. And I often think, oh God, please have a depression I can treat. And sometimes they do, and you really do get a nice response to Prozac in terms of mood, and then in turn, in terms of the need to use, to drink so much or use other drugs. But often, the folks I see, you don't. But the people I see by virtue of being in a clinic are already selected for being, you know, more resistant. But
I want to just change the question a little bit, though. I mean, I think so. We talk about being genetically loaded, but being genetically loaded for what? And it may be that what they're genetically loaded for makes them very adaptable to certain environments. I always kind of liken them to, like, autonomically, in terms of their reactivity, special forces. I mean, Navy SEALs. These are people that don't have a lot of response to fear and as a result are very effective in their environment. So I think the problem is, or the key is really to identify these children very early on and make sure that we direct them environmentally into something that's going to allow them to make good use of their special abilities.
Yeah, and I wanted to get at that, you know, the neuroscience. I mean, it's not just random. It's not like you got good images of the brains of these kids. It was a surprise that it was the amygdala that was smaller,
right.
But different parts. And so I wanted to see if you could describe a little bit the best working mechanism right now for how you get callous and emotional behavior and traits and how it has to do with the fear system.
I don't know that it's a lack of fear. I know some of my colleagues might disagree with me. It's more of a disinhibitory kind of behavior and then a shallow affect, kind of an inability to appreciate the kind of the significance that the behaviors that they do on others and that happen to them. That's been my kind of current thinking. I mean, I think, as we've mentioned, most of the, like most mental illnesses, psychopathy is, I one of those things that about half the variance is believed to be explained by genetics and the other half is environment. I mean, that's like most things tend to come down like that. In my lab, you know, we show very clear structural, you know, structural density analyses that of children who are on the same, you know, elevated spectrum as adults. And so there appears to be kind of, I would call that a risk factor. So you're born.
Could you explain the structural what you're seeing in your?
Sure. So the same circuits that you've mentioned, the so-called limbic kind of regions of the brain, tend to have essentially they're weaker. So I like to liken it akin to a muscle. So if I study you as an adult and you happen to score very high on psychopathic traits, that is, you lack empathy, guilt, and remorse, and you're also pretty impulsive. If I look at your brain areas that control those regions or are relevant to those regions, I don't want to use the word control to implicate causality, but that those regions, they're less dense. It's almost like they're atrophied. And so the question is, well, have they been that way since birth, or they developed that way because of non-use? So just like if I take my arm and I tie it to my chest, my muscle's going to atrophy right over the course of a 6 months that my bone is healing, for example. And I would go to a physician and they would say, well, Kent, has your arm always been atrophied, like from birth, or is it been there since just because you haven't been using it or something? And then they can't tell necessarily very easily. And I think that when if they find out that I've had that since I was 12, you know, the last time they assessed me or something, then they would know that it was likely been there. But it'd be a risk factor for me not being able to throw a ball far, for example, or something like that. And I think the neuroscience where we're at right now suggests that these are risk factors. That is, individuals are different, and some individuals are more high risk. And when they're more high risk, and it's precipitated, poor parenting styles is one of the things that precipitates these types of traits. And when it's aggravated by those circumstances, it can more likely end up with an individual who's going to end up seeing me when they're in prison. Yeah.
And Kayla, are you more a proponent of the there is a reduced fear response understanding?
There are some. I mean, I think there's a fair amount of evidence to support that. Mm-hmm. I think it's still an open question, to be honest.
Yeah, but it's interesting how the sort of the behavioral work, the neuroscience work, and you know everything in between and beyond is starting to converge in interesting ways. And I think that's one of the things, you know, even though neuroscience is, especially neuroimaging, is still such a young field, the fact that really the patterns you see in the brain make a lot of sense given all kinds of information that has nothing to do with brain scanning.
True. Yeah. Absolutely.
One other piece I think is kind of interesting and just beginning to emerge is there's almost like a reward response for some of these kids when they engage in these behaviors. Mm-hmm. You might want to speak that a little bit with your substance abuse mm-hmm. background, but I think that's another really curious piece that we should pay more attention to.
I would echo that. You know, most of us, just think about reward and punishment systems, most of us, the threat of punishment keeps us from doing something wrong. And in some individuals, they're less likely to respond to that threat. They're less likely to think about the sanctions or the things that are going to happen. And the people that we work with that we call psychopathic, they very, very, very rarely respond to punishment. But they do typically respond to reward. And so most of the treatment programs that I've seen that are very effective, they de-emphasize punishment and they emphasize positive reinforcement. And that type of positive reinforcement helps to get traction. It helps to change the way they think and then the way they behave. And eventually, the goal is to get them to have more positive outcomes. And that's the program that I mentioned in Wisconsin. By the way, I'm not a paid Wisconsin person or anything like that. No, none of those things. Conflicts. But it is embracing the science that we know about in terms of trying to develop it into a model that can affect change. And then hopefully then they never come before the judges and have to make those decisions.
When you say less responsive to punishment, is it that they don't fear bad outcomes, they don't imagine bad outcomes, or when bad outcomes happen, it doesn't bother them so much?
I think all of the above. For the individual at the high end of the spectrum, they don't anticipate or they're not concerned about punishment or threat of punishment. They don't, when they get punished, they're not as responsive to that punishment, and then they sense don't change their behavior based on that type of punishment, and they don't care about it.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's all of the above. Stand tight.
Mm-hmm. Nice. So we could start to, are there any questions you want to ask each other before we get to the audience question portion?
I was going to say something about deterrence.
Oh, yeah.
So would that be the last word before you're going to open for questions?
Not necessarily.
Oh, yeah. I want the last word. Well, okay, I'll just swing it back to addiction a little bit, but sort of less in the reward context is, what I mentioned earlier about this what I call a hypermedicalization of addiction, and again, which is basically the direction that the National Institutes of Health have gone. And I understand why. It's a biomedical agency, and that's what they do. They look, they adopt a reductionist approach to, you know, most things, and that makes sense for what their goals are. But it always interested me that the scans, there used to be PET scans again. For example, the typical protocol was taking someone who had an addiction, often to crack or cocaine, and putting them in a scanner of some sort, and then exposing them to a video of people who were manipulating drug paraphernalia or using it, and by doing that, eliciting great metabolic activity in the areas of the brain that responded to, or that correlated, I should say, with reward. And those same patients, when shown more neutral scenes, like a seashore, did not manifest that enhanced activity. And normal people who had no previous experience with cocaine did not show that experience. So there's pretty much no question that there's a good story here, narrative here about this activity reflecting the experience of having used drugs. And because it was accompanied by the subjective experience of either wanting to, you know, use drugs as well, like, bam, that looks good. That some have said, well, there you have craving in the brain. Well, in a way, yes. In a loose way, sure. But they would always go this other step to say, this is why addicts can't control themselves, and that's a dangerous move. And this is where it ties back to deterrence or responding to deterrence, is that when addiction was, again, formulated in this way as a brain disease, the proponent of it, who was the head of NIDA at the time, had said it's a brain disease because there are changes in the brain. Well, that's obviously a little silly because there are going to be changes in your brain, you know, when you leave here. So that doesn't mean anything that there are changes in the brain. But obviously, these are different. They're quality of changes, and drugs do change the brain. There's no question about that. But the question really is: are the changes such that people can no longer respond to foreseeable consequences? Now, in the case of some people, the answer is, and I don't mean some addicts. I mean some people with troubling behavior. The answer would be no. They can't respond to foreseeable consequences, it would be almost nearly impossible, very difficult. That's not the case with most people who have drug problems, and that's why this formulation of focusing at the neural level. I mean, you can think of behavior on so many levels, starting with the neural and all the way to the environmental factors. And that's why I've always had so much trouble with this neurological level of description for a behavior that can be so responsive to consequences. Now, let me just say one more thing. That shouldn't surprise anyone who knows about the brain, but in the public sphere, there's so much confusion. If it's in the brain, that means it's somehow something that over which one has no control. Some things that are in the brain, it's true, people have no control over. Other things are more responsive. And the trick is knowing the difference. And then if it's the latter, that it is responsive, coming up with creative behavioral modification programs that sometimes do and don't benefit from the addition of medication. And that's where the most successful treatments for addicts have been.
And that's part of the goal of both of your research, right, is to figure out which treatments right. might work, how to find out whether they're right. working.
Yeah. We do a lot of, we also do a lot of studies of addiction and how the brain does change over time. And we do see that the same circuits that you mentioned are actually therapeutically changing over time with certain forms of treatment. And the idea there is that, you know, you've used and abused a wide range of drugs, you have helped to make change in brain, but guess what? The brain changes all the time, and we can actually, you know, do some treatments, be that pharmaceutical or cognitive behavioral. In this case, it was a cognitive behavioral program. And you see changes over time in the responsiveness to those same types of stimuli. And then guess what that predicts? That predicts that they're not going to come back to drugs better than some of the other measures. So when you can institute change, and that's what we're looking for, is what can we do to implement and get those systems back to a more normal level that will allow them, you know, us to know that treatment was effective. It doesn't work for everyone. So that means those people that we think we can work with in this program go here, and these people should go into a different treatment program. With the ultimate goal is they don't end up in front of judges, you know, having to make other tough decisions based on other imperfect data. Nice. So
if you're ready, we'll open it up for questions from the audience. And just a reminder that we're being webcast and recorded, I believe. So if you do have a question, please wait until the microphone gets to you. Anybody want to start us off?
Dr. Keel, you mentioned the structural densities of psychopaths is less than normal or more than normal people?
Yeah, the results we found were less. So in certain areas of the brain, this limbic circuitry that we both all mentioned, or a number of us have mentioned, we find that it's less dense in both, these are men and boys. And you know, average, this is a study of over 300 individuals, though, so it's quite profoundly less dense.
So I guess my question is these people, these 300 people, they exhibited psychopathic behaviors and they had this less density in their brain.
Yes.
Do people who have this less density in their brain not exhibit psychopathic behaviors? I mean, if you have this, I mean, if I were to take a scan of my brain and I had this density issue, does
sure.
that define me as a psychopath, or is it my behaviors that define me as a psychopath?
So it was a clinical assessment that defined the individuals in that study and could define you as well, as where you fit on that scale. So people range from low, medium to high on the scale, and it just turned out that the higher they scored, the less dense was the data. So we can't say specifically whether or not everyone with low dense activity or low density in those circuits scores high on psychopathy. We've only studied a couple thousand people, and this was the first study of 300. We did replicate the same effect, though, in a study of 200 boys who were also at very elevated levels of the traits. But again, it's a dimensional kind of an assessment, and you find that the higher they do score, the less dense are these areas. And like I said, it conveys to me that it's a risk factor. I would be rather surprised, though, if there were individuals who fit that typical that profile that wouldn't have some evidence of the symptoms. That would be a surprise to me. But it's possible. I've not studied everyone. But I've only, you know, we've tried to move away from these small studies, which I was guilty of as well, publishing ends of 8, 10, 12, 14 subjects. And we've moved into the hundreds, if not thousands, of subjects to try to say with what confidence and how much variance is explained along, you know, with these brain scan measures.
Another question?
Yes. About 6 years ago, I used to work in mental health, and I had three patients, all of whom exhibited psychotic behaviors. Mm-hmm. One had typical schizophrenia, one had a drug-induced psychosis, and the other had a rare enzyme disorder. And what was important about each of these cases is the schizophrenic responded well to antipsychotic drugs. The woman with the enzyme disorder, atypical antipsychotics actually aggravated her symptoms. And then the woman with the drug-induced disorder wasn't really impacted. And you had sort of touched on this earlier when discussing separating bipolar disorder from schizophrenic disorder. From a treatment perspective, I'm sort of interested, do you think you're going to be able to really sort of fingerprint these disorders such that you could, maybe when these people come into the emergency room, separate between schizophrenia and a drug-induced disorder or an enzyme disorder, or is it just going to be a way to sort of rapidly narrow down symptoms, but you're still going to need sort of that trial and error phase of therapy?
Sure. So the exact goal of that study, the original one that we did, was to answer that exact question. What is that when a patient first presents to the emergency room, it's the first time they've been ill and they've had those psychotic behaviors, so they're hearing voices, delusions, hallucinations, et cetera, can the brain scan help determine what the eventual diagnosis would be by matching that person's brain now to a template of well-diagnosed other patients? And I think that we're at the point where it's helpful. I give grand rounds to a lot of different psychiatry departments, and I explain the science. And a lot of them have said, like, my gosh, we really have some patients we've been struggling with for 6, 8, 9 months. We can't figure out exactly what they're going to have, because it takes a longitudinal course to sometimes develop what the illness is going to be and what's the best medicine. So I don't know if we're ready for clinical trials yet with this technique, but that's the goal of the technique, is to try to help do that. And there may be other ways. There might be other biomarkers that might be relevant, blood-related markers, et cetera, for an enzyme-related problem, et cetera, that could be, you know, on addition on top of that. So instead, the point is that is there any way that neuroscience can help improve that? And then what if we have everybody has schizophrenia that we fit into this distribution. Is there a way even within that base? As Sally mentioned, there's people that onset at different ages, there's different courses in the conditions, of more severe, less severe. Can we help you determine what's the best medicine to put them on at the time? And if we could, that's the goal of that work. I mean, it just happens to be that the legal system has been fascinated by the fact that neuroscience actually is getting better and better able to do this, and then how are they going to deal with those images in court, basically, is what they're concerned about or interested in. Yes, sir. Oh, sorry.
Yeah, when you were speaking, it occurred to me, remember when they put to death the Oklahoma City Murrah Federling bomber, and he had kind of kept his right to remain silent. I was wondering in my mind if we were kind of extinguishing a key resource to understanding and predicting maybe future behavior patterns like that. Do you ever sense that putting to death people who have done atrocities that we might regret it later as we unlock more brain science mysteries?
Interesting. Yes.
Well, there are two questions here, I suppose. One is a feeling about the death penalty in and of itself, which I know we're not going to probably get into. The other, I guess, is what you're asking, would we regret the fact that we ended up executing someone who was truly not responsible?
No.
Oh, from a side. I'm getting on.
Their data.
Whoa. Yeah.
The ethical issue of voluntary involvement in research.
You mean you could get
presumably
a
presumably if he had
volunteered. Off the pass. Yeah, if he volunteered for one of his studies, that would be a mitigating factor.
I would have been happy to study him, but I think you've asked a bigger question. I work with individuals on death row and in different states, and we've interviewed, tried to understand how they developed that way. Again, the goal is to try to prevent subsequent individuals from ever following that path. So I think it would be valuable if we could learn a lot from individuals as much as we can to prevent it. That's the goal.
Where do we think we stand in terms of the predictive value of this? I'm thinking especially of the case where you have a very young child with, and generations of his family have been exhibited psychopathology, and this kid shows up presenting badly on a scan. Is this a minority report situation? What do we do with this kid?
That's a very good question, and I think that if there's a lot, I'm a proponent of proactively helping to treat and remediate problems. But first there has to be a problem. So if the child is just presented to the first time for the criminal justice system, I'm a fan of trying to put that kid in the best treatment programs possible to remediate those types of problems. Like I said, there's a lot, I think that youth in particular, there's a lot of capacity for change, and we certainly do not have a strong hold on whether or not we can predict with some degree of certainty, scientific certainty to use a legal term, whether or not that child that presents is going to end up on that trajectory. We just don't know. But I am a fan of trying to identify as carefully as possible the issues that child has brought to the table, be it the family incidents of the same problems, and then how you might develop a better treatment program based on what that child's presented with. And maybe the best thing is to remove them from that family environment so that it doesn't continue to precipitate bad problems. Help? No.
I would agree.
Okay.
Yeah, with your
good.
I think you'll hear about it if we disagree.
Okay, yeah. Fair enough.
I'm just trying to get a sense of how this all applies to the general population. And take, for example, the Boys Town example. There are a lot of kids with very troubled environments, very troubled backgrounds, and probably some majority don't end up having behavioral problems. I mean, is it a majority? And then of that group that get into trouble and sort of become the Boys Town pool, then how many of those are the ones that really don't respond to the behavioral modification? And you know, you're starting to look at drugs and that kind of thing. So just sort of put it in perspective with the general population. And in a related question is, you know, if you just took a brain scan of 100 people off the street, could you tell from those people who's schizophrenic, who's bipolar, who's psychopathic, or is it only once you've identified a problematic group, then you can identify the psychopaths among them?
Well, so just the Boys Town model, most of the kids that come into our program, again, with very troubled backgrounds and with a wide range of pathology, about 85% of them do really well. They go off, they graduate from the program, go off, get jobs, go to the military, or go to college. But no, I don't think the science is to the point where we can use a brain scan without using other identifying diagnostic instruments to really narrow down the pool so that imaging would actually be meaningful in any way.
You know, it reminds me of a phenomenon that researchers and clinicians tend to find themselves in, which has been called the clinician's illusion. And that refers to the fact that most of our, well, by definition, almost all of our research is done on people who, as you say, already ill, and usually not just a little ill, but really ill. You know, for example, if you want to talk about post-traumatic stress disorder, I mean, most people, let's say they've been in a horrible car crash, you know, get some variant of that, and you know, and it'll probably for several weeks they'll still have, you know, they'll still have some startle effect, and they'll be anxious and they have trouble sleeping, and they might want to avoid the situation in which it happened, want to ride in cars, but you know, what it'll resolve and they'll come to terms with it. You know, at every level of severity, more people funnel off until you see the folks that we all see, and by then it's tempting to make conclusions about all people with this condition based on this minority of people that we see. So when you said, how does this relate to probably everyday people or everyday situations where something's problematic, but you know, not the magnitude of something that's clinical or come to legal attention, we probably don't have a lot to say about those sorts of things, except thank God they usually resolve on their own, because that's not who we're studying. And I've always personally wished that we had more research on people who were able to, again, you can see my focus is always through drugs, but I meant everything I just said there was more generic. But when it comes to addiction, I'd love to see people who can handle their drugs and even handle their addiction. But we don't study these people because they don't come to see us.
I mean, I took it. Are you asking generally what can the general population take from a conversation like this? And I think that a couple of take-home messages I would offer would be that, you know, neuroscience has wonderful tools that make beautifully visually capture kind of what's going on inside someone's, you know, inside the brain. And as we get better and better, we're going to be able to help say that there are differences. There's men and women differences. There's differences between, you know, young and old. There's differences between, and as we get better and better able to match these techniques to different behaviors, there's going to be a picture of a brain of a specific behavior. Okay, there's a picture of a brain. It was always in there anyway. We just have a camera now that can take a picture of it. And the question is, what we're trying to do, most of us, is figure out how to use that picture to help implement better outcomes, how to use that to help determine better treatment, better for people. So I just hope people aren't too surprised by all the images that they're likely to see, you know, coming out in these different areas. Because most of it's pretty good science. Most of it's people trying to do their best science. And then, of course, to pick on the attorneys, you know, the legal system will distort or pervert a lot of the science for an adversarial system to fight, to use it for one case and not for another case, and to say it's aggravating or it's mitigating. They will tug and pull at that information, sometimes prematurely, sometimes it's good science that should be, you know, tug and pulled in the legal system. So that's what I'd say.
Yes, my question relates to resolution. So psychiatric disorders are complex disorders, characterizations of different behaviors. And if the DSM has so much difficulty in defining these disorders, how do you see the challenge of defining behaviors that could actually stem from different causes? So you can have fear, which is very distinct behavior, even very primitive behavior, that could be elicited by different causes. So talk about the resolution in terms of like how deep do you need to go to the brain to actually define and characterize specific behaviors?
I tried to emphasize that you know, the neuroscience is only going to be as good as the phenotype that we're trying to assess. So if we're trying to assess some transient event, like a impact of a trauma from a car crash, it's going to be very difficult to assess that with some stability for sure, especially if it resolves, but also with any accuracy. The measures that I'm generally talking about where we get good neuroscience data are traits, are things that are present for the vast majority of life in most domains of your life, and they really characterize your personality, and they characterize the problem. They're highly related to the problems that you're experiencing at home, at work, in school, and family, and friends. And when you have that kind of a trait, then we are more able to accurately map the neuroscience data at any time point, you know, to that data. And the same thing with symptoms. You know, with patients with schizophrenia, they cycle through all different types of symptoms, and there are definitely neuroscience correlates of the symptoms at the time of the scan, but there are also traits that are common across multiple time points. So what we do is we extract at the first episode when the patient presents, then it's 6 months later, and then another year later, and we look for what's common across that patient across all of those time points as our measure of the illness. The measure of symptoms is all the other stuff that's varying with the symptoms that the patient presents with. And both are relevant. Both are relevant for treatment. So you want to reduce the symptoms, you'll treat that part of the system that's relevant. And then if it's a real disease process that's precipitating a wide range of symptoms, that might have a very different treatment. So we try to take into consideration, you know, all of those things.
And I think we're about out of time for questions, unfortunately. Did either of you want to have any final comments? Before we go, there will be a greater conversation afterwards, too. Okay. All right. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, Laura. Thanks to all the speakers. That was a great conversation and great questions from the audience. Just a reminder, it's nice when you ask a question to introduce yourself. That includes you, Joel Garreau. Joel is one of our Future Tense Fellows, and he's on the faculty at ASU, and he's sort of our co-director in coordinating the Future Tense program. And in his question, you might have noticed he alluded to Minority Report, and Joel back in those years was instrumental in bringing that movie to life. I think he sat next to Steven Spielberg and figured out the script or something like that, but slight exaggeration there. That conversation serves as a great segue to our next presentation, which will be conducted by Abigail Marsh, and it's entitled Empathy in the Adolescent Brain. Abigail is the assistant professor of psychology, at Georgetown University. Her research focuses on understanding emotions such as empathy and how they relate to aggression, altruism, and violence. Abigail?
Okay. Well, thanks for a great prelude. I have a lot of overlap with both Kayla and Kent. Kent and I grew up in the same neighborhood, as it turns out, in University Place, Washington, just a few miles from where Ted Bundy grew up. Which may explain both of our ending up in this field, and both Kayla and I worked in a common lab at the NIH. In any case, I think most of us would agree that it's pretty messed up to kill the family dogs with an axe. You don't do it, and I think most of us would agree that anybody who did do it was a criminal. Michael Schardel is a 19-year-old who did kill his family dogs with an axe, and he clearly is a criminal, but that's probably not all he is, as suggested by the reason that he killed the dogs. At the time of the killing, Schardel was living at home, wasn't in school, and had no job to speak of. But for a while, his mother was willing to give him $50 a day in pocket money anyhow. The problem was that she drove a school bus, and eventually she couldn't afford to keep paying him, and she told him that he needed to find a job. Schardel's response was to kill the family dogs in the barn with an axe, so that when he returned, he could take his mother and grandmother hostage while he described in great detail what he had done to the dogs and threatened to do the same thing to them unless they paid up. So, also from Washington State. And so, this combination of an irresponsible lifestyle, parasitic orientation towards other people, and the use of threats and violence for personal gain suggests that Michael Schardel may be a psychopath.
So psychopathy is a disorder that basically robs the human brain of empathy, and it can be identified as early as adolescence. That's a period of life that, in terms of brain development, lasts from age 11 or 12 to about age 25. And not coincidentally, adolescence is when antisocial behavior and violence peak. So understanding empathy and psychopathy in this age group is especially critical. And a key thing to know about psychopathy is that it varies continuously across the population. So, you know, we've heard people talking about, are you a psychopath or are you not? It doesn't work exactly like that. Lots of functional people in the world have moderate levels of psychopathy, with a bona fide, quote, psychopath like Michael Schartl at the far end of the distribution. And psychopathy consists of two basic groups of traits. Antisocial behaviors like stimulation seeking, impulsivity, and temper tantrums. Note there aren't no actually florid criminal behaviors in that group. And then also the callous unemotional traits like low empathy, low remorse, and shallow emotions. However, not all emotions are equally affected by psychopathy. Rather, psychopathy seems to mainly impair fear, and this is something we've alluded to so far today. So, for example, whereas most people get jumpy and sweaty when they're under threat, psychopaths don't. They don't show this response at all. They show no startle response, well, and a very limited skin conductance response. And this is, by the way, one reason that the polygraph is such a problem. It measures fear responses, and psychopaths, who are arguably the criminals that we most want to catch, don't show these responses. Psychopathy also impairs aversive conditioning, which is basically learning to avoid scary things. This, again, is one of the reasons that simple imprisonment of people with psychopathic traits is a problem, because we hope that the threat of imprisonment serves some sort of a preventative effect. And in people who have no ability for aversive conditioning, who don't fear punishment, it's much less effective. And then finally, psychopathy impairs the subjective experience of fear. So clearly, psychopaths don't experience fear the way that most people do. These are, you know, some of the most comprehensive metrics we have of the fear response, and they're very consistently different in people who are psychopathic. Psychopaths also don't understand when other people are experiencing fear, so they don't recognize expressions of fear in the face or the body or the voice. And this may be essential because, and this is what empathy research is starting to show, just recognizing another person's emotional state is maybe the most fundamental basic form of empathy that there is. So as where most people can read the terror in this face rapidly and effortlessly, I hope most of us can in this room, psychopaths seem to more or less draw blank. So one psychopath who was being tested in prison got every single fear expression that he was shown wrong. Finally, and he was shown expressions just like the one we saw before. And finally, he commented, "You know, I don't know what that expression is called, but I know that's what people look like right before I stab them." Right. So clearly, he knew something about this face. He just couldn't link it to an emotion. So why would this be? Why would psychopaths be so blind to others' fear? Maybe it's because you can't really understand an emotion that you don't experience yourself. Here's a quote from another psychopath who was in prison for rape and who was interviewed by Robert Hare. And he was asked why he didn't empathize with his victims. And he said, "Well, they're frightened, right? But you see, I don't really understand it. I've been frightened myself and it wasn't unpleasant." Right? And clearly this is not the statement of somebody who really understands what it means to be afraid, I think. And so such a yawning gap in human experience suggests some sort of fundamental defect in the brains of psychopaths, no problem. And studies of people with damage to the amygdala suggest what that defect might be. So the amygdala is an evolutionarily ancient structure embedded deep in the temporal lobes of the brain, and it's known to be involved in a number of aspects of fear. And interestingly, people who have damage to the amygdala through a variety of different causes show extremely similar deficits to psychopaths. So they show no physiological or subjective experience of fear, and they show impaired recognition of fear in other people's through a variety of modalities. So if psychopaths don't feel or recognize fear, and if amygdala lesions impair the ability to feel or recognize fear, seems reasonable that psychopath problems may stem from some deficit in the amygdala. And this is what my colleagues and I at the NIH, including James Blair, set out to test in one of the first brain imaging studies ever conducted in psychopathic adolescents. And we wanted to find out whether the reduced empathy and sensitivity to fear that we see in these kids relates to amygdala dysfunction. So we asked psychopathic adolescents between the ages of 10 and 17, as well as healthy controls, as well as controls with pure ADHD, right, who also are impulsive but don't seem to have the callous unemotional traits. And we asked them to look at fearful and angry and neutral expressions while we scan their brains using fMRI. And we found that both healthy kids and kids with pure ADHD showed increased amygdala activity when they looked at the fearful expressions. And we didn't see this, for example, for anger expressions. And this is a nice confirmation of the amygdala's known role in processing fear cues. And by contrast, psychopathic kids showed either no increase in amygdala activity or in some cases, even a decrease. And this result has now been replicated several times by several different labs. So what's going on here? Clearly, fear sensitivity is impaired somehow in psychopaths, probably due to defects in the amygdala. And this seems to leave psychopaths unable to recognize fear in other people. But what we really want is an answer to our million-dollar question, which is, why do psychopaths do things that cause fear? Right? Why do they threaten people and bully them and assault them? Why do they tell their moms that they're going to kill her with an axe unless she keeps giving them pocket money? Can insensitivity to fear help to explain why psychopaths do things that cause fear? So to answer this question, we tweaked the classic emotion recognition task. And people in lots of different studies that have been done for decades now look at faces just like these and figure out what emotion each person is feeling. And we wanted to see something a little different, which is, can people figure out what causes emotions like these in the first place? So first, we generated a list of emotionally evocative statements, which are a really nice way of evoking strong, specific emotions in a laboratory context, like fear and anger. Ethically speaking, it's difficult to elicit fear and anger in some of the ways that are known to elicit them in the real world, but we can do it with these evocative statements. And then we measured the psychopathy levels of 40 adolescents and adults that we recruited from the community. And they read all of these statements, and they tried to figure out what emotion each one of these statements could cause. And then in the critical phase of the tasks, subjects read all the statements again, and they judged whether it would be ever morally acceptable to make a statement like this to other people. And again, we expected that psychopathy would keep people from recognizing what causes people to be afraid, and that maybe this can help us figure out why psychopaths don't believe that causing people fear is such a big deal. And again, usually the kinds of statements that elicit fear in people are things like threats that are used for instrumental gain or for personal gain, which is a very common feature of psychopathy, perhaps one of the defining features. So what do our results show? First, psychopathy was very strongly associated with fear blindness again, and this is a result we've now replicated several times. So people with high psychopathy scores had trouble figuring out that statements like, "I could easily hurt you," and "you better watch your back," would make someone afraid. Right? It just doesn't occur to them that that's the end result. And the judgments of other emotions were pretty normal, except interestingly happiness, which I could talk about if that's interesting. What about judgments of whether it's okay to do things that cause people fear? And here, psychopathy was closely associated with judgments that scaring people is acceptable. And then these two judgments are themselves correlated. So if you can't figure out what would make somebody afraid, you're much more likely to think that frightening people is okay, and you're much more likely to be psychopathic. So do mistakes in understanding what makes people afraid also involve amygdala problems? To find out, we ran an fMRI study at Georgetown where we asked people to make moral judgments while we scan their brains. And we used special recruitment techniques to attract psychopathic adolescents from the community, which apparently worked. Our high psychopathy sample had scores similar to those previously seen in prison populations and had pretty high self-reported. Sorry about the little format change. It looks like a Mac to PC transition issue there. In any case, the psychopathic sample we recruited from the general population reported high levels of aggression. They also responded to the statements that they read during the task pretty similarly to subjects in our first study. People with high psychopathy scores basically thought it was fine to scare people, but their judgments of causing people other emotions like anger and sadness and disgust were more or less normal. And this difference was accompanied by a group difference in amygdala activity during the task. So people with low psychopathy scores saw scaring people as a bad thing to do. And they recruited the amygdala during these judgments, whereas people with high psychopathy scores saw scaring people as no big deal, and they showed no increase in amygdala activity. And here's the percent signal change that you can see plotted out in the amygdala for both groups. So you can see this big difference in amygdala activity that, again, only pops up when subjects consider whether it's okay to make somebody else afraid. What were the high psychopathy subjects doing? This is something that's been found in a number of other moral judgment tasks with a variety of psychopathic populations as well, which is that they try to reason their way through the task. They sort of try to blunt force logic their way through decisions about whether it's okay to threaten to kill people. And across all of the different emotion categories, the more psychopathic subjects showed a lot of activity in a region of the lateral prefrontal cortex that's involved in working memory and attention during all sorts of cognitive tasks. But we assume that based on the fact that the high psychopathy subjects showed pretty distorted response patterns, cognitive reasoning through a task like this is only going to get you so far when it comes to moral judgments. So I think these findings highlight the importance of fear for normal social functioning. We all know that the fear of experiencing pain or injury is useful for helping us to avoid danger, and it's true that people who are psychopathic tend to just get themselves in a lot more hot water because they don't seem to fear injury or punishment as much as other people. But beyond this, it seems that when the experience of fear is dysfunctional, so is the ability to understand other people's experiences of fear and to appreciate the moral seriousness of making them afraid. Right? If you experience fear as not such a bad thing to experience, why would it be such a bad thing to cause somebody else? And we suggest that it's this inability to empathize with experiences of fear that they don't have that lies at the core of psychopathy, or is at least essentially related to the relationship between the callous and emotional traits and the behaviors that we see. And this obviously leads to sobering questions when it comes to adolescents who are psychopathic. Realizing that they genuinely don't comprehend the distress that their actions cause other people definitely helps us understand their behavior better, but is it an excuse for their behavior? And even if we can assume that we can reliably confirm that defects in the amygdala underlie psychopathy, and research that's been coming at this from a lot of different angles, again, not just fMRI studies, which are useful but can never be the only means of understanding anything, do seem to implicate the amygdala in psychopathy over and over again. Well, what then, right? Should this lead to harsher or lighter sentences for affected teens? And these are not questions with easy answers, as we saw from our panel discussion a moment ago. So I think maybe the best we can hope for now is that the next upcoming generation of neuroscience research gives us new options for treatment, even prevention, and maybe a means of restoring empathy to brains where it has failed to emerge.
Thanks, Abigail. So it was interesting to learn that for some people, the only thing they have to fear is not necessarily fear itself. And yes. Earlier in during the panel conversation, there was some very gentle shots taken at lawyers. So our next conversation is going to be a chance for the legal side of the equation here to have its say. So I'd like to go ahead and introduce Jeffrey Rosen to be our moderator. Jeffrey probably doesn't need much introduction. I know I've been reading him for years and learning from him. He's a professor of law at George Washington University and the legal affairs editor at The New Republic, which is one of many publications where he has written prolifically on many subjects. Jeffrey, thanks for doing this, and you will introduce the other speakers.
Wonderful. Thank you very much. Thank you. It's great to be here. This is a wonderful subject. My brain made me do it. How much is the brain defense transforming the criminal justice system? And I cannot think of two people better equipped to discuss it. Hank, please come up. I first started learning about this subject from Hank Greeley a few years ago when I wrote about it. Welcome. He has written some pathbreaking articles about its effect on the criminal justice system, and we have a lot to learn from him. I'm going to read his impressive titles. He's a professor of law at Stanford, the director of Stanford's Center for Law and the Biosciences, and director of the Stanford Interdisciplinary Group on Neuroscience and Society. And he is joined by Gary Marchant, who I've begun corresponding with, who is equally broad and illuminating in his commentaries on this and other subjects. He is the Lincoln Professor of Emerging Technologies, Law, and Ethics at Arizona State University's Sandra Day O'Connor College of Law, and the faculty director of ASU's Center for Law, Science, and Innovation. Gentlemen, so we are the legal panel, and we need to discuss, to what degree is the brain made me do it defense actually transforming the criminal justice system? Hank, when you and I started talking about this a few years ago, as well as Stephen Morse, who's taught me so much about this subject, we talked about that famous case from the early 90s involving Spider Sistkoff. Mm-hmm. And this was the guy, Mr. Weinstein, who killed his wife, by throwing her off their 12-story apartment building on 72nd Street in New York to make her murder look like a suicide. And then at trial, he introduced a brain made me do it defense. He said that he had an arachnoid or spider-shaped cyst that was around his amygdala, and this made his impulse control dramatically lessen. The judge considered the evidence and came up with a Solomonic solution. He allowed the jury to hear evidence that Mr. Weinstein had an arachnoid cyst, but not that there was a correlation between the cyst and violence. And since then, I gather, this evidence has been most likely to come in death penalty trials, given the relaxed evidentiary standard. So the defense introduces a brain made me do it defense, the prosecution counters, but it's not clear that it's actually had much of an effect on jurors. So I want to begin by asking both of you, to what degree is this evidence coming in, and how influential is it? Hank, why don't you begin?
Okay. Although, first I'd note that although we are a legal panel and not an illegal panel, Stephen Morse was also a legal speaker earlier in the day. And the Spider Siskov case, Weisskopf case, is really kind of an interesting example. The judge made that Solomonic decision, but what happened next? They copped a plea. The prosecution, knowing that this evidence was going to be introduced, then offered a reduced plea to a lesser included offense, which the defense took. So the criminal justice system is really complicated in lots of ways. Just because something comes in doesn't mean it gets to the jury, because most cases never actually go through trial. Most cases never get to the jury. They settle both in the civil and in the criminal context, one way or the other. And these are, they're chips, they're poker chips. If you can throw in some more evidence, if the judge lets you put in more evidence that might make the case go longer, might confuse the jury, might increase the uncertainty, it changes the calculation about when one settles and when one doesn't. But to get back to your specific question, we don't really know how often this is happening. We've made a few stabs at it, various people have. Anita Farahani, who's a professor now at Duke Law School, has been collecting reported decisions involving neuroscience in criminal cases, neuroimaging in criminal cases. Now, reported decisions are the tip of the iceberg's tip. They're the seagull sitting on top of the tip of the iceberg, because most cases never actually go to trial. And of the ones that go to trial, most never get appealed. And increasingly, of the ones that get appealed, most never actually lead to a published opinion. They get resolved in some very summary way. But she's found an increasing number of cases in which neuroimaging evidence has been discussed in these appeals, from 45 years ago to 100 2 years ago to her latest unpublished data. She told me a couple of weeks ago, 400 or 500 in 2011. So quite a expanding curve. The interesting thing is, many of those are for things like ineffective assistance of counsel. So on appeal, after you've been convicted, you say, well, I shouldn't have been convicted because my trial lawyer was an idiot because he didn't get my brain scan put in. However, some of them are being introduced for issues of insanity, issues of competence, issues of the ability to form a relevant intent. As far as we can tell, very few of those are winning, but it's not zero. The tougher thing to do, and I know this is tough because I tried doing it, is to try to see what's happening at the trial level, where cases are not reported. We looked by surveying district attorneys and public defenders in all 58 of California's counties for cases where neuroimaging evidence had been brought in at the trial level, because there's no general way to find out what happens at trial. And we found about 40 to 50 cases over the span of 2 or 3 years. Again, most of them failures, most of them where the defense brought it up, didn't work. What, of course, we don't see is how many of those, the threat of bringing it up may have led to a lighter sentence or may have led to some sort of plea deal.
Very interesting, and it's good to have those numbers. Gary, do you have a sense of what the latest influence is and any cases you find especially interesting?
Well, I think Hank has described it exactly right. Deborah Daniels just published a law review article looking at genetics cases and found about 80 of those cases. I'm doing a project with Lynn Godet, who's Kent's wife happens to be. We've got about 150 cases we're looking at right now. And so there definitely is a lot of cases where this is being raised. But as Hank said, these are all reported cases that it makes it easy to find them, not the ones that actually trial where it could really be making a difference. And when it's up at the appellate level, it's usually because of, as Hank said, ineffective assistance of counsel, which is a very hard standard for a criminal defendant to overcome. And it's actually gotten a lot harder from some recent Supreme Court decisions. So they're almost always losing, but not always. There's no cases really where there's any success on the guilt phase. It's really that where the action is on the mitigation, on the sentencing after someone's already been found guilty. So they've been found to have committed this horrible crime usually, and then this is tried to be introduced for the purpose of mitigation. And it's fairly actually easy to get it admitted because the standards for admission and mitigation is actually pretty low. And so it is being presented. But a lot of times on appeal, and so it's not to the jury, and the court is saying basically this wouldn't add anything new, or just be duplicative, or you waived it, or whatever. And so we don't see a lot of actual trial cases. The other dynamic is that the lawyers who are doing a lot of the trial cases aren't the best lawyers. They're, you know, public defenders who spend only a few hours on the case, and then when the person gets convicted and sentenced to death, then they have some top, much higher caliber lawyers put a lot more resources into it. But now the legal standard is very hard to overcome at that point. So the question will be, if you actually start introducing this at the trial stage with competent lawyers, will it have any kind of impact? And there are at least a couple cases. There's a brain scanning case in Florida, the Grady Nelson case, where a couple of the jurors said the fact of this brain scanning convinced me not to sentence them to death. And then a genetics case in Tennessee, where again, the genetic test combined with some other data convince the jury not to go with capital murder. So there's at least some cases where this is actually working at the trial stage, but as Hank said, it's very hard to look at it generically.
But you know, if your defense counsel, particularly if it's in the capital case, you've had a conviction, you're now at the sentencing phase, you're presenting mitigating and aggravating circumstances to the jury gets as a black box, has to listen to just about anything and decides what it wants. This has to be a real scary thing to decide whether to introduce or not, because it is a classic two-edged sword. On the one hand, the jury might say, oh, poor guy, there's something wrong in his head, it's not his fault, we shouldn't kill him. On the other edge of the sword is, this guy's a natural-born killer, we have to put him down. And I think one of the most prominent cases, one that Kent was actually involved in, the Dugan case from Illinois, was a case where the facts were so awful. I think the defense counsel figured they didn't have anything to lose. Their client was in such serious shape that the jury couldn't think any worse of him. And they rolled the dice and ended up having the jury stay out a lot longer than they expected it to. His client was still sentenced to death. I'm not sure whether you count that as a moral victory or not, but the defense counsel did think that evidence at least made the jury think harder a lot and think a lot longer.
We'll say more about that double-edged sword, which is so interesting. On the one hand, as you suggest, it could lead jurors to say that it wasn't the guy's fault, so he should get off more easily. On the other hand, if he's almost certain to offend again, you could put him in jail for longer or even execute him. And Carter Sneed has expressed concern that neuroscience evidence, if it does lead to the end of retribution, by focusing on specific deterrence, could lead more people to sentence to death, not fewer. Any empirical evidence in the aggregate about whether jurors are more likely to be moved to mercy or to execute based on this evidence?
Well, I don't know of any evidence one way or the other about that. The ends are so small that at best you'd have anecdotes. And although we lawyers like to think data is the plural of anecdotes, non-lawyers generally don't buy that.
Well, there's an interesting study just published by one of Hank's former students and some colleagues on judges in science that found a little bit of a reduction in the sentences for when you introduce a neuroscience evidence. So that's at least judges. But although the case I had a little bit of involvement with, the Jeff Landrigan case is a genetics case, the Ninth Circuit, in their decision said this is all the more reason to execute him, not less, because of that double-edged sword. So there's at least some judges who view it the other way. And then in terms of jurors, again, as Hank said, it's really just anecdotes. But if you look at the anecdotes that are out there, and you know, some of them from articles you've written, Jeff, but other ones, they go both ways. And so you wonder why, in this case, did the jurors think this one? Was it the way the expert presented it? Was the way the attorney presented it? Was the nature of the crime? It's very hard to know why sometimes it goes one way and some the other.
Yeah. The piece in Science, where my former student, Tennille, or former postdoc, Tennille Brown, now at the University of Utah Law School, was one of the co-authors, was, I think, a nice piece of work, but it's hypothetical. You ask a bunch of judges a set of hypothetical questions, and one always wonders, how realistic is that? If they're actually in the situation, would they do the same thing? That taking answering questions when they know they're in the middle of an experiment, would they answer the same way? And we don't know. That's why it would be really nice to have real data, to have enough of these cases, to have them followed, to have them collectible in a way that would lead us to be able to get a big enough end to be able to answer some of these questions empirically.
Now, what does the fact that judges and jurors are dividing about this evidence say in response to Stephen Morse's challenge? He has written eloquently about brain overclaim syndrome and noted that the idea that neuroscience evidence was going to mean the end of free will and responsibility seems hyperbolic. After all, the law generally holds people account if they act voluntarily, as long as they're not under duress or can't appreciate the difference between right and wrong, and doesn't care whether it was the amygdala that made me do it, or a bad mommy and daddy, or Twinkies. And on the other hand, there are people like Cohn and Green who say that we really are helpless slaves of our brain, that when I just gestured dramatically right now, and I thought that was an intentional act to emphasize my point, but it really, probably my intention to move my hand may have taken place 400 milliseconds before I became aware of the desire to move my hand, and 100 milliseconds before I had the ability to stop it. So if I'm just a completely determined creature, the idea that I'm intentionally acting is nonsensical. My question to you, gentlemen, is, are these philosophical debates, although terribly interesting, at all reflected in the legal debates, or are they just too abstract to really matter, and judges and juries are dealing with more practical questions?
So my answer to that, I think, is yes and no. I don't think they're
like a philosopher and a lawyer.
It's a Twinkie that made me do it. The absence of my normal morning Twinkie.
We both had red eyes last night. So.
Yeah. Wow. Right. So our frontal lobes are not functioning very well. I think that with respect to the actual judges and the discussion of legal doctrine, we're not seeing very much of this. We're seeing discussion in the standard legal terms. You know, was there mens rea? Was there insanity? Was there competency, et cetera? And not discussion at sort of a deeper philosophical free will level. I actually, though, think that the juror's reaction does reflect thoughts about free will. The fact that the jurors go in every different direction, and that all of us are torn to go in other directions, reflects the fact that we're deeply confused about free will, because it's deeply confusing. It doesn't seem, I can't figure out how I can have free will, but I feel like I have free will. That seems like a useful kind of feeling to have. I kind of believe that you moved your hand because you wanted to make a gesture and not because of your Twinkie deficit or Twinkie surplus. I can't figure out how that can be the case scientifically. And the neuroscientists who still seem to believe in some broad sense of free will wave their hands and talk about quantum mechanics and a variety of other fairly silly things, I think. But at the same time, I can't really accept that I don't have free will. I think jurors are, as philosophers are, deeply puzzled and conflicted about the reality of free will and what it means. And that means if you throw a set of attractive facts at them, you get a bunch of different answers back.
I think Ken's comment about the courts and the legal system being sort of overusing this is actually true. I mean, you think about it, it's not like science where we just have this open end, ongoing search for truth. It's a one-time shot, and there's huge stakes at issue here of people's lives and the victims' of rights. And so the lawyer's tendency would try to throw everything they can at it, any argument they can. And frankly, from the defense lawyers in a lot of these cases, they don't have, as Hank said, a lot going for them. There's, you know, the guy's been found guilty. He's clearly guilty. It's mostly a guy. And they don't have a lot of ammo to really throw at it. So they're going to, I think, throw this stuff more and more at juries and try to get it to juries and see what happens. And so we may eventually get more empirical data to look at this. But, you know, how do I come down? I had the privilege of hearing Stephen many times, and every time I hear him, I'm convinced, and yet I would still vote not to send that guy to jail, Mr. Apt, or what do you call it? Oft, Mr. Oft. I would still, if I was on a jury, I don't think I'd send him to jail. I don't know if I'd find him guilty and you know, send him to the hospital or whatever, but I don't think I'd put him in jail, and I wonder how many other people would feel about that. I don't know, but even though when I follow your philosophical...
Those are separate questions. Mm-hmm. I mean, whether mm-hmm. it's responsible and what right. you should do with them are separate questions.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right. It tried to sentence his tumor to death, but it didn't work.
Let me ask about detention for propensity. This is the most controversial potential use of neuroscience evidence. So I'm walking down the street, and a mobile brain scan looks at my brain along with a picture of a training camp in Afghanistan. And if I've not been there, I am sent happily on my way. But if I have, my brain alerts in a certain way, and I'm taken off the street and carted off to Guantanamo and detained indefinitely as a potential enemy combatant. Would this be permissible under current constitutional doctrine? Could we imagine anything along these lines, this sort of cognitive profiling happening in the future? Or maybe I should just be surveilled a little bit and not actually hauled off to Guantanamo.
You know, it's not very often that I get asked a legal question for which my answer is not, it depends. But I think for this one I can say no, that would not be allowed under current legal doctrine, and I hope that will stay at least in the United States. Although there are other countries and countries that we think of as sharing many of our views on freedom, like Great Britain, the United Kingdom, which has some stronger views about preventive detention, permissible of preventive detention than we are. Won't happen today. I think if it does happen, it's going to be a long time before anybody is confident enough in neuroscience findings by themselves. It certainly should be a long time before anyone's confident enough about neuroscience findings by themselves to do that. One of the things that Stephen, who just left, has pointed out often is neuroscience is usually cumulative. If it's useful at all, it's cumulative evidence. You start with behavior. We start with the fact that you've been downloading a whole bunch of interesting stuff from Al-Qaeda websites, that you've been inquiring about fertilizer, purchasing large quantities of fertilizer, and so on. Then maybe the neuro image is some additive evidence. And in that case, it might actually be relevant evidence that might push you over the edge one way or the other. But I think just to have the brain scans used is a big leap. I mean, even so, for two reasons. And I actually think that neuroimaging will be used in law a fair amount. I just don't think it's likely to be used for this in that kind of setting. One is plasticity. I mean, people's brains are different. Your brain may react to that in some way. 99 brains out of 100 may react to that in some way, but you may be the 100th. And right now, we don't even know whether it's 99 out of 100 or 9.9 out of 100 or 3i out of 100, I mean, the imaginary numbers. We just don't have that kind of data, and it's going to be a long time before we get it. So individual differences are going to be a real problem, particularly in high stakes like detention. The other problem is, even if you do react as if you've seen that camp before, is it that you've seen that camp or you've seen a picture of that camp? Or that camp looks like that summer camp that your parents sent you off to when you were 11 that you'd never forgiven them for?
It actually does.
Right. I mean, those kinds of problems are going to be serious no matter what. So it's a great science fiction theme. I love science fiction, but I don't think it's likely to show up in our courts in my lifetime or in yours.
Is there any
at least that way.
Address that, and also, is there any a less science fiction-y version of cognitive profiling, whereas if psychopaths have brains with underactive amygdalas and less gray matter, that might raise some suspicions for further investigation?
I don't think here, but I mean, you know, other countries, like say in North Korea, it's possible at some point in the future they could start using that kind of technology, possibly. But I think that the lesson here is the science panel is talking about is the legal system and some of the tragedies you read about there really underscore the importance of trying to use this new science for prevention. Not to put people in jail, not to punish them for having these tendencies, but to try and prevent them from occurring. You know, you read these cases are just so horrific of these horrible crimes that occur and just say, you know, could you imagine that happening to someone in your family? It's just absolutely devastating. And then, you know, even on the people who did it side, I remember I talked to the lawyer for Jeff Landrigan. So he was a guy who was adopted at a young age and had a horrible upbringing. And he made this claim that he has this murder gene. He didn't use it in that wording, but he made this claim, and it went all the way to the U.S. Supreme Court. And they ruled it was too late for him to introduce that evidence, so he never had a chance to introduce it. But the claim was he had this MAOA gene. And in talking to his lawyer, it's clear his entire life was ruined by this reaction he had. Whenever he got frustrated or really put upon, he just flashed out really violently. And he committed two murders, both where he basically was sort of provoked and he just lost control. He would do it with the judge and the cases. He would do it with his own lawyer. And he now recognizes it. He's now executed, but before he would recognize this. I just did it again, he'd say. And his lawyer is saying, you know, there's something just wrong with him metabolically that probably could have been treated with some kind of drug or some way that could have been controlled. And his life wouldn't have been ruined, and the people he killed wouldn't have been ruined. And you look at these stories over and over in our criminal justice system and say, if we could have prevented this, there's so much suffering that could have been prevented. You know, surely we can try and do better. And you know, the problem was we never had any markers, really, any factors to show that there is a risk. And now the work that Ken and other people are doing, we're now starting to get some suggestive evidence that we can maybe identify risks. Again, the great news is it's not deterministic. It doesn't mean they will do this. It means they're at a greater risk. And so, now that we have that, the question is, can we pair that with treatments? And it seems only really worth doing this if we can pair it with treatments. But if we can put some resources into finding these treatments and making them work, we can maybe prevent some of these horrible cases from actually occurring. But, you
know, Gary said the great news is it's not deterministic. If you're trying to use it as a predictor, the fact that it's not deterministic is not such great news. Mm-hmm. That's troubling news. How many false positives do you get? How many people with small, inactive amygdalas turn out not to be psychopaths? Versus how many people who are psychopaths don't have big amygdalas? What's the, to use the jargon, specificity and sensitivity, as well as the positive and negative predictive value? Accuracy turns out, you know, I've had to learn this going into bio. As a lawyer, I had no idea, but accuracy turns out to be a complicated thing with lots of different meanings. And many of them mean, I think, predicting, going from brain scans to actual future behavior is usually going to be pretty hard. Mr. Oft is a wonderful example because he's his own case in control twice. I mean, you see him without the tumor, you see him with the tumor. Then you see him without the tumor, then you see him with the tumor. Interestingly, I think that means he has no excuse in the future. If he begins to feel those urges again, he should have a duty to go to the emergency room, get himself scanned, and see if the tumor's grown back. And I don't think we'd let him off the hook if he knew that he had the propensity, just as somebody who knows they have epilepsy and should be taking their meds in order to drive isn't off the hook if they have a seizure while they drive when they haven't been taking their meds. So I think the cases like Mr. Oft are very rare, are going to stay very rare, I think, at least for a while. On the other hand, I think there are other ways where the stakes are lower, and what you're predicting or trying to ascertain is probably easier than future behavior, where neuroimaging is going to be useful in law. My own bet on this, well, I haven't bought stock in any company, that would really be a bet on it, is pain. You know, pain is in the brain. Feels like it hurts here. It actually hurts here. There are neuroscientists who think they can see signatures in the brain when people have that ouch, subjective pain reaction. That's not as sexy as psychopathy, but there are a lot more lawsuits and administrative proceedings every year in the United States about pain than there are about murder. There are hundreds of thousands of Social Security disability determinations that hinge on whether somebody's really in pain, and if so, how much. We don't have good tests for them. Now, even if the pain test is only, say, 90% sensitive and specific, that's better than we've got now, and you're not putting somebody away for life. You're deciding whether they get disability or not. So I think there are areas where this will work. I think predicting future dangerousness and doing something really serious about it, locking them up. Now, treatment, if there is a proven treatment and it doesn't have big side effects, we may be willing to treat on less powerful evidence. I think locking people away scientifically won't be justified for a long time, if ever.
Yeah, I don't think ever that's the case. I think that the risk is more stigmatizing them, right, of testing them and saying, oh, you're at risk, or telling the parents you're at risk, right, and therefore stigmatizing that kid. And so that's something that, as we do these studies and try and develop the science to be able to have better predictive ability, that's going to be a sensitive issue to handle. The false positives, if we can deal with the stigmatization issue and the treatments are not giving some radical drug, but really, you know, some better family life and some better nutrition and so on, it's not going to be a real risk of that. But so it depends what kind of treatments we're looking at. But, as I've been looking through this literature, I'm actually quite encouraged that we are actually making progress, but it's an area that's really underfunded. There has not been much funding at all in these actual treatment programs. I mean, a little bit, and there's been some really interesting initial results. Not enough to implement this on any kind of broad scale, but in terms of actual focused studies and more research, this is an area that I think would be worth putting the money into, and it would actually pay off in terms of preventing crime if it actually works.
Although if we could do it, I don't think we need neuroscience to say giving people better family lives would be a good thing.
No, but I mean, I think part of the issue is, I mean, it's just like what's occurring now in these complex neural diseases like autism or epilepsy or schizophrenia. It's a combination of all kinds of different symptoms and syndromes. And so if you can understand their biology and segment, like you can starting to do with some autisms now, and say, look at this mutation has this as a result, and this is the prognosis, and maybe this is the treatment, where this one is a different one, or this epilepsy has this and this one. You can start to do it with some of these kids as well, to say the neuroscience can help you pin down which of the trajectories is this kid going to be on, or help predict that better. And then, as Kent said, if you look at some of his papers, that's exactly what it's actually starting to show now, that you can actually predict that trajectory based on differences in some of these brain scans, as well as some of the work of Adrian Rain and others. So, again, it's not a done deal yet, but it's showing that it actually could be fruitful to follow this up.
Let me ask about a few other immediate practical effects. What about on lying and truth-telling? Hank, you've written about the possibility of being truth tested.
Right.
And could you be impeached if you refuse to take an fMRI lie detector test that's much more accurate than the current ones? Could truth testing become de rigueur in trials? And also talk about the possibility of memory downloads down the line, where you can actually download the equivalent of a video reel of someone's procedural and episodic memories.
I'll take the second one first, because I think that's still quite implausible. In part because, as far as we can tell, it's not that our memories are a master, untouched videotape file somewhere in our brain. Our memories are not like the DNA molecule, which is, in theory, not mutated, although in fact it mutates. Our memories seem to change every time we call them up in ways that are very, very difficult to pin down. I think the memory research that's going on is really interesting. The download, I think, is going to stay in science fiction for a long, long time. The singularity is not near. I don't think it's coming. On the lie detection, I am agnostic about where that's going to be in 10 years. There have been 25 to 30 now peer-reviewed studies that have found statistically significant results in being able to tell the difference between when a subject is telling the truth and when a subject is lying, with average accuracy defined as the area under the receiver operating curve as about 75 to 80%, which is pretty darn good. We're all lie detectors. If you put a trained actor in front of us and have her tell a lie versus tell the truth, we're all better than average at figuring it out, at least humans in general. We're 53% accurate compared to 50% accurate. So if you could move that to 70 or 80% accuracy, that'd be pretty good. The problems are, these are experiments, usually with college undergraduates. They're always experiments where somebody knows they're in an experiment. They've signed a consent form. They know they're not going to prison if they don't fool you. It's not very ecologically realistic. In fairness to the researchers, the IRBs won't let them be ecologically realistic. I can't go seize law students in the middle of class and pretend to arrest them and then see if they can, pass a lie detector test or not to get through.
I've got a couple you might try that with.
Yeah. There's certainly some I'd like to. But so we've got that problem. We also have the problem that nobody knows how good the countermeasures may be. So I don't know whether this is ultimately going to work. I have a very strong belief that it shouldn't be allowed in yet. We've had three court decisions One from a federal district court in Tennessee, recently affirmed by the Sixth Circuit. One from a civil trial court in New York State, and a recent one just here in the D.C. suburbs in Montgomery County in a murder case where the trial judge kept out one of these fMRI lie detection reports. I think right now those are the right answers. Where we go down the line is a tougher question. The impeachment issue is really kind of fun because there are now, by my last count, something like 11 law review articles about whether fMRI lie detection would or would not implicate the Fifth Amendment privilege against self-incrimination. And there are zero cases that have allowed fMRI lie detection in. That ratio is, I think, indeterminate, 11 over 0. Lawyers are thinking about it a lot. Ultimately, I think the Supreme Court will have to make a decision about whether this is testimonial or physical evidence. I suspect they'll resolve it as testimonial, but
I think
who knows?
The other interesting case on this lie detection is what the standard the courts use on this is. And so right now, most of the courts are applying what's called a Daubert standard, which is a standard adopted by the Supreme Court for scientific evidence back in the 90s that basically uses a science-based test for getting data into our legal system. And so this is based on a perception that I think there is some evidence for. There's a lot of junk science coming into our legal system, that the legal system was losing its credibility, and that we had to have a higher standard for scientific evidence coming in. And so our Supreme Court adopted the Daubert standard that applies to all federal courts and many of the state courts. An interesting question is should that be the standard for this kind of test? And so Fred Schar at the University of Virginia suggested no. The legal system has different interests than the scientific community. The scientific community can study an issue forever. We can afford to be very conservative, take our time, avoid error. You know, we don't want the cold fusion, so we're going to be very careful and really replicate everything and wait till it's, you know, been tested many times before we accept some new piece of evidence or some new theory. In the legal system, for the people involved in that case, it's a one-shot time, and then they're out. The decision is made by the court, and that's it. You know, there might be an appeal, but then that's it. Their lives are then determined by the outcome of that case. And so should we still apply that very high scientific standard to this new kind of novel evidence? And I'm torn on the issue because, you know, the last thing we want is the courts to be flooded with all this junk science of, you know, who knows what. But on the other hand, it seems waiting until it's, you know, really solidly established before we use something that might be better than what we use now. So that's the standard that Schauer is predicting, is saying the framework, and he doesn't necessarily say where it would come out on this lie detection, but the framework should be, is this more higher chance of getting to the truth with this technology than what we use now, which is, you know, the 53% accurate that we are as natural lie detectors. So if it can beat that standard, maybe we should use it, even if it doesn't meet the Daubert standard.
Well, I'm not torn on this one. I think Fred's wrong. Okay. You know, some sort of scientific rigor.
He criticizes you, so I'm sure you two are at odds on this one.
We're actually reasonably friendly, but he's wrong on this one. And if you take the shower view, I've got a magic eight ball I'll be happy to sell you. The mere fact that current systems aren't wonderful is no good excuse for putting a new one in. And I think Fred confuses the 70 to 85% accuracy. He's saying his view, I think he implicitly assumes that the real problem is that 75 to 80. It really needs to be 95 to 100. But the real problem is the 75 to 80 real in the real world? And we don't know the answer to that. We don't have a clue whether this works at all in the real world because nobody's been able to test it in the real world. And that, to me, is the real problem with Fred's analysis.
I'm going to ask one more question, and then we have time for one or two from the audience. And here it is. Are the Fourth and Fifth Amendments, as currently interpreted, adequate to restrain neural law? Hank, you mentioned that you might think, under the Fifth Amendment, of neural law evidence as being physical, just like blood, and therefore not revealing anything substantive. On the other hand, maybe there's a core of cognitive liberty that's fundamentally violated by peering into someone's brain. And as for the Fourth Amendment, the protection against unreasonable searches and seizures, some courts might say I put out my brainwaves the same way I put out the trash, and I have no expectation of privacy in my brainwaves. On the other hand, it seems like a quintessential search of my person and effects to scan my brain. So do we need a new Fourth and Fifth Amendment?
The same way the GPS on your car puts out your location?
Yes, well, exactly. Or, if we have a third-party doctrine that says I share my brainwaves.
Do we still have a Fourth Amendment?
A little bit more after the Jones case last year, but you're right that it's not clear
possibly.
That the... the amendment is adequate to constrain GPS or brainwave technologies.
So I'm just a simple country lawyer. I try to avoid the Constitution.
I'm going to reach for my wallet when I hear that one.
I try to avoid the Constitution as much as possible because as uncertain as neuroscience is, it's a lot more certain than constitutional interpretation. I do think, though, that there will be many things that will fit within the bounds of current constitutional doctrine that should make us profoundly uneasy if neuroscience advances in its abilities to try to draw inferences from physical brain states to subjective mental states as far as we think it's likely to. That's basically what this is about. This is saying we can look at your physical brain state in the fMRI, which is just looking at blood flow. It really is a snapshot of a physical phenomenon. And from that physical brain state, we infer a subjective mental state. If we get better at doing that, I think there are things that the Constitution will not protect, both under the Fourth and the Fifth. One could hope for a penumbral kind of argument about the First Amendment protecting a freedom of thought. And there is one Supreme Court case that talks about freedom of thought. It's a reading pornography in the privacy of your home case,
Stanley in Georgia.
And I don't think the justices had exactly this in mind when they were doing that, although that would require mind reading on dead justices from me. But even more fundamentally, the Constitution, except with respect to a very few things, only stops state action. And I think private actors actually worry me more than the government, well, worry me at least as much as the government, whether those private actors are employers or insurers or in some cases parents and their children or in some cases children and their elderly parents. Now, I think that's something the Constitution is not going to help us with. And I think we do need some statutory protections. I mentioned Nita Farahani before. She's working her way through the amendment. She's got a Fourth Amendment piece, a Fifth Amendment piece. She's working on a Confrontation Clause piece. I really am not a con law person. I don't remember. It's sixth or eighth?
Sixth, I think.
Yeah, I think so. And she's going to do a First Amendment piece, but basically she's writing something called On Cognitive Liberty, in which she argues the Constitution will not be enough, and we will need something more. And I think she's right.
I mean, I think in the short term, you know, just a practical matter for functional MRI, you know, you basically have to consent to hold still. I mean, if you move your head, you ruin the test. And so right now, I don't see it as an issue at all. But if you hear these reports of various national intelligence agencies trying to get a remote brain scan where they shine a beam on your forehead from some distance away, and I don't know how, you know, when or if ever that would actually manifest, but if that was to exist, then, you know, if you're walking down the street, you're apparently out in the open, and you know, just like many of our rights are not protected in that kind of scenario, then maybe your brain wouldn't as well. You're emitting them out into the air just like you are. You're leaving your DNA behind on a cigarette butt or whatever, and you don't have a protection in that.
And I do think this is part of this broader problem of not just third party, but of the technology allowing us to be tracked and watched more closely, whether it's closed-circuit television, whether it's GPS, whether it's our cell phones, whether it's our DNA. If we ever got the ability to do surreptitious brain monitoring, whether it was brain monitoring, things that weren't a problem 200 years ago, technology is making a problem today. And the court, well, I think the court needs to confront it, and whether or not the court confronts it, I think society and legislators need to confront it. Maybe not today, maybe not tomorrow, but soon and for the rest of our lives.
I think we have time for one or two questions from the audience. Yes, sir.
Mostly we've heard two different contrasting approaches to the use of neuroscience, sort of the diagnostic use, which is mostly about identifying potential treatments, and there seems to be a general favor for that, and the exculpatory use, which is, as it's been described here, it's been mostly desperate cases and mostly failed. But I wonder if in the future we'll have these two uses sort of bumping into each one another. If some kid at Boise State, for example, he's diagnosed, he receives a series of treatments, and you know, over the course of his life, the treatments fail. And so eventually he is, in fact, convicted of some major offense. Might his argument not be later, it's the treatment. I mean, I was mistreated. You diagnosed me early. I cooperated, and look what happened, you guys. You guys are implicated, in fact, the causal story.
There's a little bit of analogy in some of the addiction discussions of you know, if we're finding either brain patterns or genes that predispose you to addiction, does that create a greater duty on you to avoid taking the first drink? And so you could turn your question around, and that's Sandy asking from ASU, since you're supposed to identify yourself. You could turn the question around and say, you know, that you know you have this predisposition. Do you have a greater duty to, you know, control yourself? So you could not just blame the treatment, but you could be blamed yourself more, too. So it could go the other way, but it's all in the future.
More questions? One last one.
We've stunned them into silence, Gary.
We've, in that case, ladies and gentlemen.
I think we've got one there.
Yes?
First of all, I just wanted to maybe correct the record a little bit. Having been a public defender for over 10 years, I would take issue that the worst lawyers are public defenders who only spend a few hours.
I didn't mean that. Sorry. I mean, a lot of the greatest lawyers are public defenders, but they often, the people get assigned to the trial initially are, you know, and you hear all these cases of these ineffective assistance of counsel. They spent literally 6 hours on the case.
And right, and a lot of those people are actually from states who don't have public defender offices. Right, okay. They are appointed counsel, but they're not public defenders.
Good.
I just wanted to
set
that straight for the record. And also with regard to the point about the Guantanamo Bay scenario, I mean, I think I disagree with that assumption also that it's not already happening, because it is with the civil commitment of sexually violent predators or sex offenders. I mean, it's considered a civil commitment, and technically these people have already committed crimes for which they were sentenced, but then they complete their sentences and then go through this, quote, civil process where they're essentially locked up indefinitely. And I do think that with these brain scans, I think that if the technology is there, it is going to be used probably first on these people in this type of civil setting, because it's not a criminal case. It doesn't have the same high standards of proof, and these hearings and these trials are essentially already happening, and there's already a battle of experts going on about, you know, whether these people are dangerous and for how long.
Yeah, the sexually violent predator cases, the civil commitment cases are really interesting, I think. But thus far, at least, the Supreme Court has said you have to have been convicted of a crime, and you have to have some continuing mental disability or mental problem. As long as that first part still stands, you do have to have been found guilty of some criminal behavior, and the subsequent civil commitment is not, in theory, punishment for that behavior, but there has to have been some behavior first that was criminally punishable under the current doctrine for this to happen. I think to jump ahead and to say, Rosen hasn't done anything yet, but that amygdala is really disturbing, which I suspect many people
have
might,
said,
might wonder,
yeah,
right?
Absolutely.
Just push it on social media. We don't need to.
you need new constitutional doctrine in order to permit that. Does that mean it won't happen? No. I think it's rather unlikely here, in part because I think the ability to get the kind of sensitivity and specificity you'd want without strong behavioral evidence is unlikely to come about. And good defense lawyer can then bring in 10 random people and show that 8 of them, including, you know, 2 bishops, a rabbi, and 3 judges, would be committable, have exactly the same amygdala as Jeff. I'm not going to worry about it too much, but I'm not going to completely not worry about it at all. And there are certainly other countries where I'd worry about it a lot. I mean, I think predicting future behavior is going to in most cases, be difficult. Telling an immediate emotional reaction may turn out to be a lot easier. You know, you put a bacon cheeseburger in front of me, and my brain will do very bad things. I can imagine places that might want to scan people and show them pictures of the dear leader or the dear successor or whatever he is at this point versus the leader of South Korea, and decide, use that sort of emotional reaction as a way of deciding who's fit to live in the workers' paradise or other kinds of things. And, you know, to take it out of everybody's favorite boogeyman, North Korea, there are neuromarketing companies that are kind of trying to do vaguely the same sort of thing about Coke and Pepsi. So I do think there are reasons to be concerned. I think the criminal justice system, in terms of even in a civil commitment phase, in terms of preventive detention, isn't the top of my list, but it's on the list.
Gary, final thoughts, the last word?
No, I think it's going to be an interesting future. Just really the early stage of it, I think this kind of evidence will be introduced more and more in criminal cases just because there's really nothing else really going and it occasionally is winning, and so it'll be interesting to see how it plays out.
Well, I may have an overactive amygdala, but I understand the duty of a moderator, which is to end on time. So please join me in thanking our panelists.